from Delaware Stadium in Newark, the Danny Rocco era begins for the Blue Hens. Two teams sharing the first date, opening up their seasons in front of what should be an electric atmosphere. Tonight, it's the University of Delaware Blue Hens and the Delaware State University Hornets. You're listening to 94.7 WDSD-FM. I'm Scott Klatskin in the ValueDaysFuel.com broadcast booth alongside Matt Janis and on-site producer Mike Baumel. On the field handling sound is Mike Diodati, and reporting on the sideline is Corey Nido. And Matt, lots of anticipation, tons of excitement, hundreds of new season ticket orders all leading up to tonight.
That's the beautiful thing about, I think, this entire situation. Not only do you have a fan base that has its enthusiasm completely renewed and a different level of excitement about Delaware football from this community, but you also have a student body that's engaged as well. The students continue to file their way into Delaware Stadium. They have been locked into this process. And most importantly, you have a football team that believes in its coaching staff and feels like they have a winner in town, a guy that knows how to show them the way to take from potential to the opportunity to execute and get the results that they have been searching for over the last half decade. I think it was Troy Reeder who said it best this week. He told us that he and his upperclassmen teammates have already recognized in only 9 months with Danny Rocco that eventually he's the type of guy in this type of program that's going to bring a national championship to the first state. Now their goal, Reeder is a junior with his 2 years of eligibility left, and the seniors who were in there last year, they want to be part of that process and reap some of the rewards. And that's the beauty of this year, because not only is it a long-term building project, but there's a lot of talent in place. Danny Rocco, in his 11 years as head coach, has never had a losing record, and he doesn't plan on starting it this year. You're going to see a lot of heavy formations. I think the tight end's going to be a big factor in this offense. Certainly, it's still going to be a downhill running football team. We don't want to act like this is going to be a different idea of the offense than what we've seen in years past. They're physical, they're ground and pound, but they are looking to create some balance, and I'd be very surprised if we don't see some opportunities through the air in the early going to try to get that started.
Hens will start in shotgun, first and 10 from their own 29. First play of the season. Yoakum to the left of Walker. Behind him stands Thomas Jefferson, and they'll throw to start. A pass is caught by Jamie Jarman on the outside to the 36-yard line, and that's a good pickup, a good start to the season. Seeing Walker connect with Jamie Jarman, there was a whole lot of that happening in the summer.
Timing of that throw, perfect from Walker. Hits his back foot on his drop, releases it perfect, right between the hands on the number, and then Jarman, a hands catch, didn't let it come in on his body, which was really a struggle for him a season ago.
So it's contact lenses, Matt. We talked about it a whole lot, but we're looking for a big season out of Jamie Jarman, the former Delaware player of the year for Indian River. First running play of the season is going to be stuffed for a loss back at the 35-yard line. The tackle was made by Brian Cavacante, preseason All-MEAC third-team selection. They're expecting big things out of Cavacante for Delaware State. So the Hens pick up about seven on first down, go backwards a yard for third.
And now I think this is the area that will determine Delaware's season in many ways. They've got to be able to stay on the field on these third and mediums. Third and long's probably still going to be a challenge, but this is the area they struggled last year. You've got to be able to keep your offense on the field.
Two wide receivers to the far side. Walker in shotgun form. Two wide receivers to the left. Balance set. Running back is Thomas Jefferson, standing behind the junior captain. Walker steps back, releases. Tough catches made by Scarf. He was defended, and he got to the 40. That's enough for the first down, and I like what I've seen. Joe Walker throwing the football hard. Delaware had trouble catching those passes a season ago. Charles Scarf making it happen.
You know, Scarf was a wide receiver to start last season, transitioned back to his natural position at tight end. He is really looking forward to playing in this offense. He feels like tight end is going to be a big part of what Danny Rocco likes to do, and I think third down, that's going to be a big key. Essentially, he went to the sticks and then posted up the defender, got him positioned, and then made a nice grab in traffic.
Big target at 6'5", 270, the transfer from Rutgers. First down, 13:06 remaining in the first quarter. First series of the game, and Delaware and Del Sar tied 0-0. Thomas Jefferson running to the left side, cuts it back, had some room ahead, but he was tripped up by Brock Nichols after a 9-yard gain. It'll be second and one.
The jump cut for Thomas Jefferson really can be fun to watch because he's such a big man. And you used to hear the previous coaching staff, Dave Brock and company, talk all the time. He is a big guy with the power you would expect for somebody that size, and yet he has the footwork of a much smaller back. He is elusive, he is shifty, and he can stop and switch directions on a dime.
Two wide receivers, Jarman to the far side right. Cherry closest to us near the Delaware home sideline. Second and one. Ball on the Delaware 49-yard line as Yoakum, one of the captains, goes from left to right of Walker. The give is to the running back, Thomas Jefferson, on the right side. Picks up enough for the first down as he crosses midfield. Garfield Heslop with the tackle for Delaware State.
Well, we've seen three plays already where Delaware has lined up with a fullback. Not your traditional fullback. We're not going I formation or anything like that. But with the shotgun, Yoakum lined up almost as an H-back position, and he threw a great kick out block that time. He has really become much stronger this year, and I think he's going to help open up some holes to get those Delaware running backs' legs moving, and that's what will get him to the second level.
Kyle Yoakum, a captain. You won't find his name ever in a box score, though. He does all the little things like you just mentioned. First and 10 for Delaware in Delaware State territory for the first time at the 49. High snap. Give is to Thomas Jefferson. He breaks one tackle. Can't get through the next, but a powerful run by TJ getting to the 41-yard line of the Hornets, and Ulysses De Los Santos with some other white jerseys helping out.
Yeah, pretty good blocking up front. Noah Bay, the new body from Penn State University, got out, showed his athleticism to throw a pretty good block. Brody Kern, who's moving pretty well here in the early going after he dealt with some nagging injuries a season ago, he got out to the edge and threw a pretty good block as well.
And we're going to see Bay, Farinella, and Lutz all kind of rotate at that offensive guard position. Second and two for Delaware at the Del State 41-yard line. 11:06 first quarter. No score. Jamie Jarman in shotgun form with Thomas Jefferson standing behind him. The give is to the junior running back. Check it. It's Kareem Williams. His first carry gets to the 37-yard line, and that's a first down for Delaware.
And I think that'll be another thing that'll be very important to keep these backs fresh. You're going to be a run-heavy offense, and you have the depth at the position in order to keep them healthy long-term, but also have some punch in that fourth quarter. Remember, this is a Delaware team that really faded in second halves a year ago, and when Wes Hills was banged up constantly, so much of the load fell on Jefferson's shoulders. Now you have two healthy bodies. Hopefully you can keep them that way, Williams and Jefferson, all year.
Great to see Kareem Williams back on the field.
Absolutely.
For Delaware after redshirting a season ago. First and 10 for Delaware at the 37-yard line. Option pitch is dropped by Kareem Williams. He's trying to make something out of a bad play, and he gets caught back at the 46-yard line. Call it 47-yard line. So just a drop for Kareem Williams on the option, and that'll send Delaware backwards.
The little mistakes are something that has haunted this team each of the last two seasons. It's one of the reasons why they have been a 4-7 football team. You've got to make sure you take care of the little things before you try to do anything grand. And that time, I thought just a little bit of an errant pitch that time from Joe Walker. I thought it was a little bit up on the top shoulder of Kareem Williams. And, you know, it's a ball where Williams maybe could have made Walker right, but you've got to be a bit more accurate with that.
Thomas Jefferson back in as running back on second and 21 from the Delaware State 48-yard line. And Walker will roll to his right side. On the run, going to throw, and it's caught by Vinny Papali at the 31-yard line. The Hens pick up a big chunk, making it third and manageable.
Great to see Vinny Papali come back. And you're right now, you got a third down and four that you're set up with. A 17-yard pickup. Very accurate throw on the move from Walker. He looks really confident in the early going. And Papali did a good job running to open space, found the hole in the zone, and just kind of sat there and created a target. Walker hit him right in the chest. Boy, Walker's been sharp thus far.
Walker starts 3 of 3. Papali, his first catch of the season, missed 6 games a year ago. Third down and 4 from the Delaware State 31-yard line. 8:55 first quarter. Opening drive still. No score. And it's Joe Walker. Blitz coming up the middle. Not picked up. Walker's pass is deflected on third down. I believe Atwater Stevens got his hand up there. It was Cavacante who came untouched up the middle and forced the quick throw from Joe.
Great drop that time by Damon Atwater Stevens. That's understanding what Delaware was trying to do there. They had Scarf lined up at the sticks, and that was the hot read for Joe Walker. And Atwater Stevens just dropped right into his passing lane. And Walker probably fortunate that that ball was not intercepted. That was a fine play by the linebacker.
We see Jake Roth come in for the field goal try on fourth down and 4. Ball on the 31-yard line. This will be a 44-yard attempt for Jake Roth. It has the distance. Is it lined up? No. Wide and to the right from Jake Roth. Frank Rago was the field goal kicker last season. And on the first try of this year, Delaware comes up short. No score after Delaware was putting together a nice drive. We're going to take a timeout. Your PNC Bank timeout score. Nothing here in the first.
As a decent person, good husband. Is that it? Good? Of course not. Parent of the year? Better. Making her heart skip a beat. Thump. Undeniable. Like a boss. Like a pro. We couldn't agree more. We are professional grade. For a limited time, get 20% below MSRP on almost every 2017 GMC Terrain model. That's nearly $8,000 below MSRP on this Terrain.
Drives up the field but gets no points out of it as Jake Roth missed on a 49-yard attempt, and he might come in for those longer field goal tries. Wide and to the right, so we'll see Delaware State with the football in just a moment for the first time. And want to remind our listeners, if the Hens get 20 points in this game, you score 20% off your dinner bill at Klondike Kate's on Sunday. So if the Hens put up numbers, you can get a discount at Klondike Kate's. Just share their post on social media or hand in your ticket stub, and dinner on Sunday will be 20% off thanks to Klondike Kate's.
Nice job by the UD staff there. They brought in the Canal Little League softball team that made it to the national semifinals in the Softball World Series, the Little League World Series earlier this year. They just got on it. Got a big round of applause for the people here at Delaware Stadium. Good drive by the Hens, but that missed pitch threw them off schedule and kind of put the kibosh on that drive.
Delaware State starts first and 10 on their own 31 with a run to the right side by Bryson Allain. So a change in starting quarterback after Keenan Black was announced as the starting quarterback for Delaware State. It's actually Jack McDaniels, the true freshman from Virginia, that'll start.
Is Kenny Carter coaching Delaware State or is Jim Harbaugh? We're playing games with the depth chart. I'm surprised they had a roster online, like Michigan still doesn't have one.
Trips to the right side for Delaware State on second and 9 from their own 32. High snap, Allain gets the carry to the 35, and he's tackled by Buck Jones, bringing up third down and about 6 for the Hornets. I thought we'd have depth chart issues maybe in the second half of this game, but DSU never makes it easy in an opening contest.
They are trying to use Delaware's aggressiveness and speed against them, though, here in the early going. They ran counter on the first play. That time, they ran misdirection with the tight end pulling left. The speed sweep to the right. That was a great tackle by Joe.
Back-to-back carries by Allain. Makes it third down and 6. In motion goes Selby. And they'll make it 3 in a row for Allain. Trying to push the pile up to the 41, but won't get there. Shy of the first down. So a 3 and out for Delaware State to start. Bilal Nichols, the last man to get up for the Hornets.
Yeah, I think they called it forward progress even down by the 39 before that. And that's an interesting play call there, Scott, because you had a third down and six, depending on what you want to look at it. And they go with a downhill run against a Delaware defense, which the strength of it is the linebackers and the defensive front and stopping the run. So maybe they're trying to shorten the game, hang around as long as they can. That's an interesting third down play call.
Back to punt is Fidel Romo Martinez, and he gets it off Jamie Jarman back to return. That's a good punt. Backpedaling is Jarman. He's going to let it bounce into the end zone. So a touchback, a 61-yard punt by Romo Martinez. 41 net, and Delaware's offense will get back on the field. So a good showing by that 3-4 defense of Delaware to get things started. 7 minutes left in the first quarter of action. Still no score. That's your PNC Bank timeout score as we take a break from Delaware Stadium.
The official bird of Delaware isn't red. It's not green or purple. It's blue. Coincidence? We think not. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware. This blue hen does not need to see a podiatrist. But if he did, waiting for a referral might get his feathers in a bunch. And he wouldn't like that one bit. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing.
It's not too big, not too small.
Looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
Delaware's offense coming back on the field after they went 40 yards on their first drive, but came up with no points.
Well, the Sioux Tech are a little late arriving here. They are still filing in. It is almost all the way full behind the end zone, about to start to fill up on the far side as well.
Great looking cockpit tonight for the Blue Hens, and they had a pep rally earlier in the week that was very successful. Hens on first down. The give is to Jefferson. He cuts it once, twice, still moving his feet to the 30-yard line. Picks up a first down on the first down run. It was a tackle made by Moses Dupree for Del State.
I think you have to really enjoy the watching how many Jefferson run. There's not a lot of wasted movement. It's shiftiness, but it's not a lot of lateral movement. It's just a quick step right, quick step left. Make the guy miss and then can charge it forward and use that big frame to your advantage. He's a downhill runner, but a little elusive rather than a guy that wants to be super elusive and never gets moving downhill.
Ran for 700 yards a season ago, now a junior from Prospect Park, New Jersey. To the left of Walker stands Yoakum. The snap goes to Joe, and he gives it to the running back who gets to the 33-yard line. That was Jefferson again. So it's going to be second down and 8 after the 2-yard pickup by Delaware.
Yeah, Malik Harris did a pretty good job that time off the edge. Delaware's having a hard time keeping the outside linebackers from getting penetration. I wonder how much of it is Delaware State playing so downhill and trying to force the Hens to beat them over the top. But the one area where the Hornets have been able to slow Delaware down has been penetration from the edge.
Second down and 8, ball on the 34-yard line of Delaware. No score, 5:43. First quarter action. Standing behind Joe Walker is Thomas Jefferson. Blitz coming from the right side. There was some movement. Flag is thrown. And that's the first penalty of the evening. Like Brandon Whaley might have got a head start.
Well, start offense number 81. 5-yard penalty. Remains second down.
Pretty sure, Scott, that was Whaley's first snap, and he was just hyped up. He was ready to go. I think he was probably involved in the pass pattern. These tight ends, when you talk to him before the season, they think they're going to be such a big impact on this offense, and they're just so jacked up. But you got to temper that excitement and make sure you don't let it create some mistakes.
And Whaley was injured for a lot of last year, only 6 games after that All-CAA performance in 2015. Second and 13 after the penalty as Yoakum switches from left to right, now back to the left. The pump on the left side. A pass by Walker is caught by Jarvin on the screen at the 30, looking for room to run. Doesn't have much. Gets out to the 33-yard line where he's down. A pickup of 4. It'll be third down and 9 for Delaware. Cream Rogers on the tackle.
That was really well defended by Delaware State. They had some action moving to the right. Walker did a pretty good job to try to move the defense with his eyes. But Delaware State just stayed at home, and they really had that quick screen, the slip screen action, and Jarman bottled up. Too many bodies for Jamie to try to weave his way through.
Third down and 9 on the Delaware 33-yard line. The running back to the left of Walker is Thomas Jefferson. 4 wide receivers, trips to the far side right. No score, 4:30, first quarter. Walker dropping back, throwing towards the sideline. Jarman with the catch. He went to the sticks and got the first down for Delaware. Jarman playing exceptionally well to start.
That was a perfect throw from Joe Walker and all time. That's 2 timing routes now with Jarman that has been delivered perfectly. And we talked about it all last season. David Jarman became a much better route runner. He has won many catches. So far, he's run 2 excellent routes, and he's completed the catch both times for first down.
He's got 3 catches for 23 yards already. Ty Pitts in the game, the freshman. On the far side right on first and 10 from the Delaware 43-yard line. Walker, shotgun snap. Give is to Jefferson. Not a lot of room to run. Good pressure by the defensive line of Delaware State. Again, Cameron Rogers, a transfer from Wesley College, in on the stop.
Awful lot of penetration that time off the left edge. They're having some surprising success pushing that Delaware offensive line back on the outside. I'm not sure if it's a timing issue right now that's kind of throwing Delaware off, because you would think the Hens would have a pretty significant advantage in that area.
Cherry and Jarman, now the wide receivers on second and 11 after the loss of 1 on the last play. 3:19 to go. First quarter action. Here's Thomas Jefferson. Run to the left side. Gets him up across the 45-yard line. It'll be third down once again for Delaware. Hens 2 of 3 on third down conversions thus far.
That time it was just chased down from behind by Jones. They're trying to slow the pursuit of these edge rushers down with some misdirection. That's the third counter we have seen thus far in the early going. Delaware State is much more athletic, though, defensively than they seemed a season ago. They seem to move much better at the linebacker position, which is surprising because they lost some bodies there.
Third down and eight, ball on the Delaware 45-yard line for Walker. No score. And Walker will fake the give to Jefferson. Throwing down the middle, has a man, and it's dropped. What would have been a touchdown for Deontay Cherry. Hit him between the 8 and the 0. And instead, it's fourth down.
Another perfect throw from Joe Walker. You can't put it any more on the money. Essentially, it was a long handoff. And Cherry's a guy who really didn't struggle with drops a season ago. He was the most sure-handed receiver that the Hens had. And he wasn't about to get hit. Maybe he was checking to see where the safety was and took his eye off it a little bit, but that's a shame. That was a walk-in touchdown.
That was a beautiful throw by Joe Walker, and Cherry, the senior, he's got to catch that pass. On the punt, there was some movement. They're going to whistle it dead.
That's the kind of play you got to guard against becoming deflating for an offense.
Offside. Defense, number 25, 5-yard penalty, remains fourth down.
Mike Waters jumped into the neutral zone and induced the movement on the outside from Jones. But we saw that happen to Delaware so often last season, and you thought you had kind of nipped it in the bud, and Jamie Jarman seems to have in the early going, but now it's contagious. It's moved on to a different body. The good news is it was a senior. You feel like Terry's mentally strong enough to get past it.
We'll see Nick Pritchard for the first time in the punt game, the transfer from Maryland. It's high, a good-looking punt. And Del State can let that bounce. Has a chance to be down inside the 5. It will be. A nice roll as Jackson got to it at the 2-yard line. Great debut by Nick Pritchard. A 48-yard punt. Pritchard, the redshirt sophomore, started 12 games as a freshman for the Maryland Terrapins. Actually debuted against Danny Rocco and the Richmond Spiders 2 seasons ago. Didn't play last year when Maryland went to a rugby style. And for the second straight year, Delaware and ACC transfer punter off to a good start.
Yeah, the transfer route has worked pretty well at that punting position. You wondered how you would replace Eric Anderson, who was one of the best in the country a couple of years ago. Worked out last season and first effort, long field here for Delaware State. I like that Delaware didn't get greedy there and try to let that thing roll inside the 1. Down at the 2. 2 is almost as good as the 1-yard line. It's not worth the risk.
McDaniel will start at his own 2-yard line. No score, 2:17 first quarter, and a lot of movement on that line. Kaden Crawford, I believe.
Offense number 66. Half the distance to the goal. Remains first down.
And there you go. Now you get it back at the 1-yard line anyway.
You get back that half a yard or yard that you would have had. How'd you let it take a bounce? Here's Jack McDaniels at QB. Tough spot for Delaware State as Mike Waters comes in as the running back. Delaware showing some heat. Chance for a safety with a tackle for loss. McDaniels calling out orders to his team. Single back is Waters. In motion goes Godinette. They go to Waters, and he is brought down in the end zone for a safety. Ball comes loose, picked up by the Hens. And they're going to mark it as a safety before the ball came loose. 2 points, not 6, but what a defensive effort by the Hens.
What a job by Delaware up front. Blaine Woodson got some penetration. And the guard, it was just an absolute miscommunication. They let Cam Kitchen come in untouched. And you're not running through big Cam Kitchen's grasp. That is a great stand-up tackle. Because if he gets pushed back even a little bit, he sneaks out of the end zone. But Kitchen, who is so improved from a season ago, he's bigger, he's stronger, and still kept his athleticism, took advantage of a missed assignment there, blocking wise. It came in virtually untouched, and they have a big stick in the end zone to get Delaware on the board. Who had safety for the first score in the Danny Rocco era in their pool?
How about that? We did have Cam Kitchen looking to be an improved player this year from a season ago when he was a sophomore and had 32 tackles and 2 sacks. He did have a sack last year against the Hornets. It wasn't worth any points, though. He gets 2 right there for the Hens to go up 2-0 with 2:07 left in the first quarter of action. Some exciting defensive plays to start.
The way the offensive line blocked up front, it almost seemed as though they thought it was going to be a keeper, that McDaniels was just going to kind of ride his center and charge forward, because they all converged to the middle, and Kitchen was absolutely untouched. That is just a really, really brutal mistake for Delaware State to make after they had played, let's be honest, Scott, a fantastic opening quarter. For them to be in a tie game 12-plus minutes into this contest was a win.
The punt after the safety will go the direction of Nasir Adderley. It went over his head. He wasn't expecting that far of a kick, but he gets at the 10-yard line, now at the 20, dancing at the 25-yard line, cutting there to the 30, and gets out to the 34-yard line, where Delaware will start their next drive. Hens have 70 total yards of offense, but no points offensively. The first just a moment ago coming from Cam Kitchen's safety. So it's 2-0 starting this drive for the Hens.
Now you look at the little flags on top of the goalpost. They're oscillating just a little bit. You look at the flags out on top of Hannah Stadium, the baseball field just across the way, and anything that's a little bit higher, they are whipping across the field into Delaware's face. And give the Hornets credit there. They've got a good punter. Fidel Romo Martinez is a third-team All-MEAC preseason selection, and he's punted like he might be better than that thus far in the early going.
Hands come out on offense with Kareem Williams as the running back. Kareem, 2 carries, 6 yards thus far. First and 10 on the Delaware 34-yard line to start the drive up 2-0 with 2 minutes left in the first. Walker wants to throw. He's got time to do so, and he's picked off at the 40-yard line. It was Keewon Selby, a 3-time first-team All-State player for St. George's Votech in Delaware, came up with the INT, but there is a flag back towards the line of scrimmage.
Holding. Offense number 54. That penalty is declined. The result is an interception. First down.
Two problems there, Scott. You had 2 wide receivers in the same vicinity, which I can't think was the design of the play. I think somebody was a little bit off on their route tree that time. And then just a flat underthrown ball from Walker. His first misfire of the football game. It just comes at a bad time. I like the play call. Take the shot off play action. You had Downey's commit, or you had Delaware State committing forward. You just didn't quite get enough air under it, and you had too many guys in the same spot. Essentially, you allowed 2 defenders to blanket 2 guys because they were all in the same spot.
Selby, the interception. The junior from St. George's Votech, as I mentioned, resident of Bear, Delaware, so a hometown Hornet with the INT. Football back for Delaware State. First and 10, ball on their own 42-yard line. And hit in the backfield is Mike Waters at the 40. That'll be a loss. And Charles Bell, the 2-time captain, with the stop.
Now, Charles Bell is a guy that's awful easy to forget about sometimes because you have so many playmakers at linebacker. But Bell has been arguably Delaware's most consistent defensive player the last 2 seasons.
McDaniels will go in shotgun form on 2nd and 12 from his own 40-yard line, 1:27, first quarter. Some movement before the snap, and they'll blow it dead. And that's going to go against Delaware State. That'll be their 2nd penalty with movement.
False start. Offense, number 68. 5-yard penalty. Remain 2nd down.
You're hearing the voice of Jeffrey Genzajewski. I looked at the name, and there was a lot of consonants. I almost didn't give it a try, but my apologies to the Genzajewski family.
Well, Matthew Dirks, a freshman with a false start that time, and that's part of the problem for the Hornets. They don't have a ton of freshman starters, but they have a lot of underclassmen. Between freshmen and sophomores, as many as 16 that are amongst the 2 deep for the Hornets.
Back split next to McDaniels in shotgun form on 2nd and 17 after the penalty. McDaniels going to throw. Pumps, finds his man at the 40. It's caught. Catch was made by Teron Selby, Keewon's brother. One plays defense, one plays offense. And it was Charles Bell with another stop. 50 seconds left in the first quarter, and that will bring up third down and 12.
Kenny Carter is not what you would refer to as a truth teller. He said how important it was to try to get some balance offensively. I think right now he's looking at a scoreboard at a 2-0 game. That was the first throw of the ball game for Delaware State. He's just trying to shorten this one and stay around as long as he can.
Ball at the 40-yard line for DSU, third and 12. In flat, pass is caught, but tripping up at the 40-yard line, getting back to the line of scrimmage, was Giovanni Downey, the sophomore running back. So that'll be fourth down for DSU. They can let the first quarter run out if they want to.
If I'm Downey, I'm taking a lot of choppy steps there as well. When I'm staring down Charles Bell and Troy Reeder and no blockers out in front, that's not a situation you want to be in if you're a guy with a football. The 40-yard line made a heck of a tackle, but Reeder and Bell were in position to make one pretty quick thereafter.
That'll be the final play of the first quarter of action. Delaware takes a surprising 2-0 lead in a quarter number two. They'll have the football when we get back. Your PNC Bank timeout score after one quarter, Delaware 2, Del State nothing.
Whether you're a morning person or simply it's not your thing. Maybe you're the type that doesn't take it that seriously. Or you're that person who just makes everyone's morning brighter. There's a McDonald's for every morning.
Enjoy a sausage burrito for $1 or a sausage McGriddle sandwich for $2. Pair it with any size freshly brewed McCafe hot coffee for $1.
Back to WDSD, where we flip the field to start the second quarter with a punt, and Jarman going to take it. Contact immediately at the 20-yard line where he caught it, and the tackle was made after the 40-yard punt by Jordan Hanna, a wide receiver for Delaware State, getting it done on the special team. So the Hens offense came out strong but didn't get points on the board after a fumbled pitch. And now they'll get a chance to get some points on the board on this drive. They've been on the field for 11 minutes, over 11 minutes of action, but no points yet for Delaware offensively.
Some positives, but the overwhelming issue right now for Delaware has been just a couple of missteps. It's attention to detail, and those are the types of issues that you expect in the opener. It's the pitch that's a little bit off that threw off the schedule of that initial drive where they had so much positive momentum going. It was a situation, second time they had the football, where a couple of penetration plays off the edge, maybe a missed assignment from an offensive tackle kind of hurt you and got you behind schedule. And then that last possession, try to take a shot after the safety, all the momentum on your side, and you have two guys pretty much in the same area receiver-wise, and a flat throw from Joe Walker, a bad combination of mistakes. So long-winded way of saying it don't feel like they're that far off, but you've got to clean that up here after the first quarter of play. You kind of get a mulligan with some nerves. The season opens.
And oddly timed media timeout gives me a chance. So as we look at some first quarter stats, Thomas Jefferson leading the way on the ground, 7 carries, 30 yards. Kareem Williams returning to action after redshirting a season ago, 2 carries, 6 yards. Joe Walker, 5 of 8, started 3 of 3. A drop that would have been a touchdown, very deep, counting against him in that category. 45 yards total, does have the interception. Jarman has 3 catches. He's looked good for 23 yards. Charles Bell, 2 tackles. Reeder with 2 for Delaware. Finally ready to start this second quarter drive for Delaware as they get back on the field.
Here's the issue right now that I have. Expected this offense to look more dominant running the football. They have not had as much success as you anticipated coming into this game.
Walker and shotgun behind him, Kareem Williams, as he continues to rotate with Thomas Jefferson. First and 10 on the Delaware 20. Give is to Williams with some speed into the secondary before first contact to the 28-yard line, maybe 29. It'll be second and 1 for the Hens. A tackle made by Garfield Heslop.
Boy, what a block by Brody Kern. Just crushed the left side of that Delaware State defensive front and opened up a huge hole for Williams to work his way through. He went low and got the defender down off his feet. Mario Farinella also had a pretty good block up at the second level as well.
Williams stays in as the back on second down and 1 for the Delaware 29-yard line. Shotgun is Walker. Moves up to talk to the captain, Brody Kern. And the senior center, snaps it to Joe Walker. Again, it's Williams, again up the gut, and he picks up a first down, 3 yards before contact. Swarm of Hornets stop him at the 32, but it's enough to move the sticks.
You know, Kenny Carter talked about coming into this game that felt as though his defense had grown up a lot over the course of the second half of last season. Now, they lost some key bodies, so there was some unknown there in terms of what they would be capable of. But second year in this defensive system, they're not getting blown off the football like they did a season ago. I think he has to be really encouraged, despite the fact they've kind of statistically been dominated thus far.
Two wide receivers to the left. To the right side, excuse me, of Joe Walker. He'll fake the give to the running back. Throw that way. Cherry catches that one at the 40. Cuts it at the 45. On the run at the 50. Across midfield to the 40. And down he goes. Deontay Cherry with a big pickup. As the Hens get into Hornets territory with the 30-yard gain.
Really well designed. Jarman's deep threat ability drew the attention of the safety over the top. And some miscommunication. Delaware State did not account for Cherry underneath. Both defensive backs went with Jarman down the field. And you get Cherry the football a little bit of space. Boy, can he be elusive. And good to see him look that one in that time.
Hens driving into Hornets territory. 2-0 lead. Two wide receivers to the left side. Williams is the running back, standing behind Walker. The give is to Williams, tripped up as he gets to the 35-yard line. And it'll be second down and 7.
That's a heck of a tackle by Isaiah Small. Shoestring stop. That was set up pretty nicely. Farinella out in front. If he does not trip him up, that might sneak to the end zone. I'd like a little bit more what we've seen from Delaware's offensive line on this drive, beginning to look like we anticipated they would coming into the ballgame. They weren't bad in the first quarter. They just weren't quite as overpowering as you anticipated they have been on this possession.
I believe we see Gene Coleman in for the first time. Split out to the left side on second and 7 for Walker on the Dell State 35. Walker has some time, lobs it up over the head of Jarman, who had his defenders beat. It falls incomplete.
That's a nice post from Jarman. Put to the outside, and then the sharp break straight to the center of the field. And I thought Walker saw that coming open and maybe just rushed to throw a tad. He's trying to throw on anticipation, which you can't blame him for. But Jarman popped wide open. You put a little bit more air underneath that football, let Jarman run underneath of it.
Third down coming up for the Hens. Delaware 2 of 4 on third downs today. 12-13, second quarter, a 2-0 lead for Delaware. Yoakum next to Walker. Williams stands behind. Jarman Cherry the far side left as a Walker awaits the snap. His feet at the 40. Makes a handoff to Williams. Williams picks up the block. Walker going to try to run. To the outside, he cuts it at the 30. First down yardage to the 25. 20, still on his feet at the 10. One more cut down inside the 10. A flag comes late, but Walker with a huge pickup inside the red zone. 26 yards for the QB.
Came down the field. It's going to be a first down either way. It just might not be quite as deep as Delaware ended up.
Officials talking it over.
Illegal block in the back. Offense, number 80. Is being led from the spot of the foul, 10 yards. The result will be a first down.
They move right back outside the red zone. I think Deontay Cherry just trying to do a little bit too much. That's an error of effort. And I think if you're Danny Rocco, you can live with that. It was a heck of a run by Walker, who started right, came back to the left, made a little shifty move in the center. And Cherry, if he could have gotten his body in front, thrown that block, Walker probably does sneak to the end zone. He was just a half step late and got the back shoulder of the defender instead of the front shoulder he was aiming for. And that's the reason for the penalty.
It's a freshman wide receiver set as Pitts is in, Coleman is in as well to the right side of Walker, who goes under center for the first time, offset eye. In motion, Charles Scarf also to the right side, so tight trips. Give is to the running back. It's Kareem Williams, a burst of speed. He's untouched. Has blockers at the 10, to the 5. He's tripped up. A big pickup by Kareem Williams, and the Hens go in the red zone for the first time after an 18-yard gain.
How power formation, unbalanced, with the tight end shifting to the right, both wide receivers that way. And that's the thing about the two freshmen. They're good blockers for young guys, 18, 19 years of age, but physical out there, you know, big body targets, but also when you're a big body, you get involved in the running game, trying to free some space for Williams, and they certainly did.
Jarman and Cherry to the left side of Walker in shotgun four. First and goal to go. Delaware up 2-0. Walker moving up to talk with his lineman. He sends Yoakum from left to right. Ball in near side hash. High snap. It goes to Williams. Williams running to the right side. He's brought down at the line of scrimmage. Brock Nichols was in there.
Your eyes are impressive, Scott. I know you got that LASIK surgery a couple of years ago. I can't read these numbers, these Delaware State uniforms. They're light blue, and they fade away as they go down the uniform. But Williams was in there, as was Ulysses De Los Santos. I thought De Los Santos really did a good job of stringing that play out. He was being blocked, but he kept his body in Williams' path, and that's what took away the cutback lane and allowed the pursuit to catch the play.
Second and goal to go from the same spot, the 6-yard line. Walker in shotgun form. They'll keep it on the ground with Williams. Williams gets across the 5 and powers his way to about the 3-yard line. It'll be third down and goal to go for Delaware, approaching the 10-minute mark in the second quarter. Delaware leads 2-0.
I would be shocked if this is anything but two-down territory here, which is why if I'm Delaware, probably a pretty good chance to try to run the ball. Delaware State's hanging around, two-nothing ball game. I would look at maybe Nance, try to get the ball in Williams' hands, running to the outside. He's got the speed and we seem to beat him in the air.
Scarf. Papali and Cherry to the left of Walker on third down and goal from the 3. Walker going to throw. Pressure comes. Walker avoids it momentarily. Running to the right side, and he's hit at the 5-yard line. Forced out of bounds by Brian Cavalcante. And it'll be a fourth and goal. We'll see Frank Bragg.
And my mistake there. It's a new era of Delaware football. I've just gotten so used to the ground and pound situation. They go a different way. They try to spread him out and hoping to get Walker to the edge. Delaware State just played it aggressively. They blitzed from the outside. Linebacker got in Walker's face right away and forced him to have to really move his attention more towards eluding the pressure than trying to find his targets. And when you have to wait that long to find somebody, the defense is going to use the boundary as an extra defender. There was just no room.
Frank Rango in as the kicker for this 21-yard try. Holder is Pritchard, and Rango gets this one up and in. So first we get 2 points, then we get 3. It's 5-0 Delaware as Rago boots it through.
Rush hour or relax hour. It's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
Floats it into the post to Nick Harrison.
We've all been there.
Can't even see the score.
Oh my God.
Trying to watch the game on that tiny screen. It's time to watch sports the way they were meant to be watched. On this, in high definition, you can now watch all your favorite teams and players on the big screen for free. With CAA.TV, you'll never miss a moment. Take back the living room by searching CAA on your device.
Welcome back to WDSC, your home for Blue Hens football. I'm Scott Klatsky alongside Matt Jens. Mike Bumble running things here, producing in the studio. And we've got Corey Nido down on the sideline. Let's welcome him back into the broadcast.
All right, thank you, Scott. Well, Joe Walker, the offense, stalling twice in the red zone, but that has not put Walker in a bad mood. He's walking with his head held high. He's all over the offense. He's talking to the backup quarterbacks, and you can tell that he's poised on the sideline. He realizes that this offense is just knocking on the door to finding the end zone. Good sign for Walker despite some of the stalled drives. Scott, back up to you.
Especially after what Danny Rocco asked for from him during the offseason. Corey, that's a great point. To be a little bit more vocal, a little bit more of a forceful leader, and sort of hit a little adversity in the early portion of the campaign, and to be able to keep your head up and to still be a little bit out of your comfort zone and try to be that guy who's controlling the offense, controlling the sideline. I think Danny Rocco will like that. Now, I think he will also like it more if Delaware can clean up the little things that are hurting him right now. But give Delaware State credit. I got to be honest with you. The penetration they've been able to get in this first half, I didn't see it coming in any way, shape, or form. Their outside linebackers and their DNs have played a really strong first 20 minutes.
9:08, second quarter, 5-0. Delaware on top is Rolfe. Kicks this one away. Elaine back to return. It sails over his head. And we were impressed last year by Jake Rolfe's ability to kick that ball out of the end zone. We see it again that time.
Now the wind's certainly starting to pick up now, moving with Delaware from left to right. I guess for Delaware State, I don't think the wind's much of a factor. They don't seem like a team very determined to throw the football. I mean, two pass attempts so far, they've both been short underneath throws. They were supposed to be a more balanced group this year. It has not worked out that way. The Delaware offense has shown some signs of things to really like. The Delaware defense has shown nothing but things to really like. It has been a dominant performance thus far from the Hens. They have allowed a grand total of 10 yards in 21 minutes. That's pretty darn good here in the early going. Five in the air, five on the ground.
McDaniels is the freshman quarterback still after Keenan Black was announced as a starter. The freshman comes in so far for Delaware State, first and 10 from their own 25-yard line. He's got back split next to him, and he'll look to throw for just the third time. It's high and batted down by Malcolm Brown near the Delaware State sideline. It was Teron Selby reaching for it, but nice play by Malcolm Brown, who had three pass breakups a season ago. He's a redshirt junior, another guy that's been here for 4 years.
Delaware
State, yeah, going to go quickly. Second down and 10 as they're already snapping the football. It's going to be an option play, and the ball is loose, picked up by Charles Bell. It's Hens football inside the red zone.
Well, one ref giving it to Delaware. The head linesman is saying down. I think they're going to go with his call. Unfortunately, it was a very late
the
whistle.
The ruling on the field is the runner was down by contact.
I hate to admit it, but I think they got that one right. I do think the ground caused the fumble that time. It was a heck of a hit.
Delaware State looking like they went too fast for their own good that
yes,
time.
I agree. They just didn't have anybody blocking on the edge.
Third down and 14 after the loss and the break for Delaware State, as Delaware did pick up that fumble after McDaniel was down. The freshman quarterback going to throw. Chucks it. It's caught by Selby in traffic at the 30. And Bell comes in along with Ray Jones to make the tackle at the 32-yard line, shy of the first down marker. A good pickup. They got 12, but they needed 14. We'll see the punt unit.
Oh, man, Jack McDaniels is so lucky. He threw a bad ball there. Troy Reeder had his eyes locked on the quarterback's eyes and jumped that and was in between the quarterback and his target. But the ball was up and behind him, and so it went over Reed, and it was actually a great catch by Dell State. But Troy Reeder got a pick six last season against Delaware State. He was an errant toss away from a pick six there, and finally a touchdown for Delaware in this first half.
We'll see Romo Martinez back to punt. He's looked good so far today. Jamie Jarman going to return. He had no return on his last try. A low kick for Romo Martinez, bouncing at the 30. It'll roll, and it'll be down at the 30-yard line of Delaware. A 37-yard punt by Romo Martinez with 7:22 remaining in the second quarter. 5-0 Delaware. We saw a safety from Cam Kitchen and a field goal of 21 yards from Frank Rago. Delaware has moved the football offensively, but unable to get six so far on the board.
Impressed by Romo Martinez. He's got both bumps in the bag. The high ball with the wind in his back, and that time the line drive, he was able to sneak it through the wind and kind of get a little bit of roll. And Corey Nino reporting a little bit of a drizzle down there on the field right now, he said.
Starting to rain a little bit. We'll see how that impacts things as Delaware comes out with the football. First and 10 on their own 30, 7:22, second quarter. Walker will start in shotgun form. The running back, Thomas Jefferson, he took a break on the last series. Two wide receivers to the right. Ball on the far side of the field as Walker takes it. Turns, fires, caught by Cherry. Spins off one tackler, spins into another, and brought down by Kewan Selby, who's having a good night already. An INT and a tackle there. 9-yard pickup. It'll be second and one.
Well, it seems like they've started this drive with such gusto. 8-9 yards. That's the third time we've seen that on the first play of the drive. And they've strung together some first downs. They just haven't been able to sustain the momentum, which is normally something you'd expect from a team that's one-dimensional, but they've been balanced thus far.
Walker getting shotgun form on second and one. 6:48 second quarter. The runner is Thomas Jefferson, untouched as he gets to the 46-yard line. And we saw some of those tires come up, the new turf, as he slipped crossing the 45. No one got to him, but the ball goes down at the 46. It'll be a first down.
That's because Noah Bay moved Elshon Williams about 5 yards. I mean, you were talking about, you were mentioning the tire pieces that were jumping up. He looked like a car running somebody over that time. That's how far he moved the defensive tackle for Delaware State.
New field looks beautiful, by the way, here at Tommy Raymond Field at Delaware Stadium. First and 10 for the Hens at their own 46-yard line. Two wide receivers to the far side. Again, Jefferson looked for space, turns the corners, gets to the 50-yard line, head down. Tackle made by Selby, but the Hens into Hornet territory. Close to a first down. In fact, he got it. So the sticks move again, thanks to Thomas Jefferson.
Brock Nichols got caught in some traffic in the middle. He thought he got held. I don't think so, looking at the replay. That's just a great jump cut yet again by Thomas Jefferson to the outside. Boy, that is an effective weapon for Jefferson, the ability to just change directions as quick as he does.
Hens over 100 yards rushing on the day. And Thomas Jefferson to the left side, cuts it back. Stiff arm at the 35. And again, a big pickup on first down. It'll be second and 8.
Cavacante is unblocked, filling the hole in the center that time for Delaware State. And Jefferson single-handedly made a miss.
He's looking good. Under center goes Walker. They want to pick up the speed. It's a bootleg, and Walker going to run for the first down. Pushed out at the 32-yard line by Cavacante. Got back to the line of scrimmage, didn't pick up much more. Walker's upset, there was no one behind.
That's a busted play. I like you calling it a bootleg. I'm sure Danny Rocco will appreciate that as well. But, you know, that was a miscommunication. That's another one of those mistakes that we were talking about. But it was a fortunate mistake because he got a decent spot, and they end up moving the sticks.
And we see Walker yelling at his players, some energy that maybe we didn't see in past years from now, the captain, Joe Walker. He did get to the first down yardage, though. Although the play didn't work, he did pick up two they gave him. So first and 10 at the Hornets, 32. Delaware up 5-0. The running back, Jefferson, he'll get a carry to the left side. Big hole, cuts it back. Spins at the 27-yard line. So a pickup of 5 on first down. Devin Smith with the tackle.
But Devin Smith covered an awful lot of ground to go get Thomas Jefferson that time. And Jefferson tried another cut.
Hands going quickly once again. Jefferson another carry, a missed tackle in the backfield, and Jefferson to the 24-yard line, a 4-yard pickup, making it 3rd down and 2. Hens picking up the speed here. And again, Delaware driving the field. We've seen this throughout the first half of action. They've yet to get it in the end zone. They find themselves 4 yards away from their second red zone visit. 5-0. Delaware leads Del State.
I like slowing it down here. Make sure everybody's on the same page. This is a very important play.
Substitution coming in as Kareem Williams will be the running back, giving Jefferson a breather. Shotgun form for Walker. They need 2 yards for a first down. Walker approaches the line of scrimmage, talking to Brody Curran and his linemen. A lot of pressure coming from Delaware State. It's going to be an option play. Walker going to keep it for a first down and more to the outside. Dragged down, a touchdown saving tackle at the 10-yard line. Again, it's Kewan Selby having himself a night. But a 14-yard pickup by the quarterback puts the Hens inside the red zone.
What a burst of speed. We just marvel at Walker because he doesn't look like he's going to run away from you until he turns it up. You're running step for step with him, and then he just has another gear that you get the feeling linebackers aren't expecting. They had him strung out, and then he just beat him to the edge.
Walker's second run that has gotten Delaware into the red zone. Doing some work with his feet. Can Delaware score a touchdown for the first time? It's first and 10 from the 10. Williams, a stiff arm to the outside, can't turn it up. Pushed out of bounds at the 8-yard line by Brock Nichols, a sophomore from Florida.
Bay lost his leverage that time on the edge and just did not have the angle as a result on Garfield Heslop. And Heslop forced that one wide. Tracks. Delaware State's had more with this Delaware offense. They can't seem to match their speed on the perimeter when you have the full field. But as it combines inside the red zone, they have really stiffened.
Second down, goal to go from the 8. Delaware a 5-0 lead. Williams the running back. Walker in shotgun form. Two wide receivers to the left. Rolling that way is Walker. Throwing. It's wide for a diving Deontay Cherry. And Kewan Selby in coverage that time, made it difficult for Joe Walker.
Bacon bootleg going to the outside, and he had Jerry open. He just couldn't get his shoulders in position to throw that football. Had he gotten it out a half second sooner with the throw he just made, it's a touchdown. But when he didn't get his shoulders aligned, I thought a good decision by Walker to put it a little further outside. And if Terry dives and gets it, great, but there's no chance at the interception.
2:31, clock stop, second quarter. Delaware up 5-0, third down and goal to go from the 8. Tight to both sides as Walker's pass is deflected. He was looking for Thomas Jefferson, but Garfield Heslop got his hand up for the deflection. And it'll be fourth down in the red zone for the second straight series.
Heslop's unaccounted for, Scott. And the idea there is get it out of your hands quick. And it's Jefferson one-on-one. And in the open field, you like Jefferson's chances to catch it and get into the end zone. But Walker couldn't quite switch the angle to get it over Heslop. And again, pressure in the face of Joe Walker. And he hasn't had the passing lane. And Delaware has to settle for 3. They move the ball, but they're not getting it in the end zone.
Rago made from 21. This will be from 25. Richard will hold. Snap comes his way. Rago's kick is up and through. Frank Rago, 2-2 on his field goal tries, and Delaware leads 8-0. 2:22 remaining in the first half. That's your PNC Bank timeout score.
Down to our last two teams in the 12 teams in 12 day series.
Score another field goal, makes it 8-0 with 2:22 remaining. That's how the Anchor Buick GMC drive ended. And now another kickoff for Jake Roth into the back of the end zone. So no return again. It'll be Delaware State football as the Delaware defense continues to play well. And they get back on the field. Your Anchor Buick GMC drive summary, 12 plays, and it ends with a field goal for UD.
So situational football here for Delaware. Got a big wind at your back. You've got 3 timeouts. If you're Delaware State, you're just trying to get into the locker room, down by 8 points right now, right, Scott? You have to be encouraged by that after the result in this stadium a season ago. The Hens got to start to be thinking about quick stops, call your timeout, 3 and out here, get your offense back on the field. These are the types of things you gain an extra possession, especially with Delaware State slated to get the football to start the second half, that can change games, especially when you get into conference play.
McDaniels will start under center. He'll give to the running back, burst his speed as he gets to the line of scrimmage, but I believe Cam Kitchen met him there. A gain of maybe 3. As we approach the 2-minute mark here in the first half, we'll give him 4 yards on that first run. Second down and 6, ball to 29 of Del State.
Kitchen and Bilal Nichols, that's a pretty big pair to try to run through.
Elaine is one of the backs. We see Bryant Dallas as the other for the first time. McDaniels will go in shotgun 4. Takes the snap. Pressure coming from Nichols. McDaniels steps up in the pocket to find his man down the field. Pass caught by Sula. Got it into Delaware territory at the 45. That's the biggest pickup of the night thus far for the Hornets.
It's a great job by McDaniels to climb the pocket, escape a little to the right. That bought him critical time and gave his receivers an opportunity to work open. They haven't had that chance to take a couple extra steps so far tonight on the limited times they've actually dropped back to throw it. And now Del State's looking for points.
McDaniels in shotgun form at the 47 of Delaware. He pumps, has all day to throw, does so. Sasua got a net, but overthrows his target around the 10-yard line. Good coverage by Malcolm Brown, who was step for step.
High discipline that time. They try to double move, pump and go. Brown step for step on his side, Watson on the other. No pressure whatsoever, so they have to cover for, again, an extended stretch. And just fantastic coverage. But if you're the Delaware defensive line, we'll start to get a little bit more pass pressure here.
Empty set for McDaniel on second down and 10. Ball in Delaware 47. Trips to the left side for the freshman quarterback who awaits the snap. In motion goes the running back, and McDaniel going to try to run for it to the outside. Malcolm Brown all over it, and he wraps him up for a loss.
My goodness. They almost ripped the jersey that time of Blaine Woodson. Didn't call it. as Delaware will take a timeout to try to preserve clock. And yet Woodson was still able to string the play out and allow Malcolm Brown to sneak in from the edge to make the tackle. I mean, how does the official miss that? Directly in front of both the umpire and the linesman. Full extension on the jersey grab. That's brutal, but the Hens get away with it. And I beg your pardon, I'm not sure how they can confuse these two guys, because there's a big difference between Armin Ware and Blaine Woodson, but it was Ware being held. Either way, a blatant misfold.
Numbers are tough sometimes, all the way up here in the ValleyNationFuel.com press box. Well, Delaware calls a timeout. Remind our listeners that this offseason, my wife and I purchased a new vehicle from Chevrolet of Dover. The Chevy Equinox has everything we need, from style and technology to performance and safety. Got it from Chevrolet of Dover. Worth the trip. If you're up here in Newark, I got to say, worth the trip down to Dover. If you're in Dover, it's a no-brainer. We loved working with them, and they made us feel comfortable in our vehicle decision. Chevrolet of Dover.com. Find new road. 1:27 to play, first half, and as Matt mentioned, Delaware calling timeouts to preserve some clock, trying to get downfield if they get the football back before heading into the locker room. A third down and 14 for DSU here. Hens will have two timeouts left if they get the football back. McDaniel in shotgun form, dropping back. Has some time. Here comes Kitchen. McDaniel with the throw. A lot of air under it. And it's caught at the 10-yard line by Shua Gadanet. Into the red zone goes DSU. The catch by the sophomore from Hawaii.
Underthrown football. Watch it. Got beat that time. And no safety help. And landed a little wheel route up the seam. Forced Adderley that direction. And Watson had no help over the top.
First trip to the red zone for DSU after two big passing plays by McDaniel to Sua Gadanet to get him in position to score. And busting up the middle is a lane down at the one-yard line. And it'll be second and goal to go. 3 feet towards a touchdown for DSU, and they want to go fast. Under a minute to play. Down 8-0. McDaniel under center. Tries to keep it himself. I think he bobbled the snap.
Did he get it back?
There's a pile at the one-yard line. It looked like he fell on it, but didn't get to advance the football because he didn't have a grip of it, and it is McDaniel right now.
I don't get it, Scott. I don't get it at all. Delaware State will take a timeout here. They have three. I go fast there. I understand you're trying to catch Delaware napping, but the coaching staff has to see that the Hens got up, were in position.
Yeah, Delaware wasn't napping.
Yeah, call timeout from the sideline. You have three. Use your opportunity. You don't trust your quarterback to do it. Take care of it. Kenny Carter can race down the sideline, get placed up, say, hey, let's think about this and get a better play call out there. And what's a critical stage of this game? If Delaware State gets a touchdown here, remember, the Hornets get the football to start the second half, and it is a much different situation, and the momentum that they would take into the locker room, it would be, sea-changing to what we saw over the first 30 minutes, how the game felt play out. I'm surprised. Now, you still have at least one more shot from the one. You haven't won a game in how long. You might take two shots to try to get this one into the end zone if you're Delaware State, depending on how this play rules out. But time's not a factor. You have 2:35 left. Two timeouts.
Delaware State won the final game of the 2015 season. They have won one of their last 22 games. So this would be big for the Hornets if they can go down one or tie at the break. The running back is Elaine. It's 5-yard carry. Got up to the 1-yard line. Third down. Goal to go from the one. Elaine again to the outside. And he is wrapped up for a loss by Buck Jones.
You can't beat speed like Delaware has. A slow-developing outside run, and in waves, they were all over that one. Jones took the perfect angle, unblocked from the outside. He just swooped in. You're not going to outrun Buck Jones if you're Delaware State. Very surprised. If you're going to run wide, you would have to think a little misdirection would be mixed in. Maybe they thought Delaware would overload everything up front, but I just feel like the Hornets really shot themselves in the foot with play calling there once they got an opportunity inside, not only inside the five, inside the one.
But what that tackle for loss does for Delaware State is it pushes them back, and now they'll have to try a field goal attempt, it looks like.
And then they panic. Yeah. Why did they call timeout with 25 seconds left? you can kick a field goal. Not, is Delaware probably going to do anything in the final 19 seconds? Likely not, unless a kickoff return happens. But why? I mean, why call the timeout with 25 seconds and not wind the clock down? They just don't seem to be thinking moves ahead. They seem to be kind of flying by the seat of their pants over there a little bit.
Be a 24-yard try for Wisdom and Zidi, and it's blocked, but still has enough to get through. So Delaware State on the board, making the score 8-3. That's your PNC Bank timeout score as we take a break from Delaware State.
How do you want to live? As a decent person? Good husband? Is that it? Good? Of course not. Parent of the year? Better. Making her heart skip a beat. Thump. Undeniable. Like a boss. Like a pro. We couldn't agree more. We are professional grade. For a limited time, get 20% below MSRP on almost every 2017 GMC Terrain model. That's nearly $8,000 below MSRP on this Terrain.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing.
It's not too big, not too small.
Looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
Summary as DSU gets on the board with a field goal of 24 yards by Wisdom and Zidi for DSU. 8-3 to score, 21-6 left in the first half. Delaware does have two timeouts left. They get a return from Adderley or Buck Jones, who made a big tackle to force DSU to try the field goal. It's a short kick at the 30-yard line, and out of bounds it rolls. And a penalty flag throw.
Hens took their time going after that football, and they had Selby streaking down the field, and he almost was able to bat that back in bounds. He was about a step shy of getting to that ball.
Out of bounds. Kicking team. Ball is placed at the 35-yard line. First down.
Delaware relaxed and just assumed that ball would go out of bounds. That's a live football, though. You got to go run over there and just make sure it gets to that sideline. That's a total live football. That would have been an utter disaster.
Hens 135 yards on the ground, 83 through the air. We'll have all the halftime stats for you. We'll take it to Benny Pinello, who has scores around college football with IBW Local 313 halftime report. That's coming up in 21 seconds. We'll see what Delaware can do with it or if they try to do anything with the football. Looks like they will, as Walker will come out in shotgun four. Delaware starting their drive at their own 35-yard line, and Walker back to throw. Stepping up in the pocket, hit as he throws to an open Jarman at the 48-yard line. Out of bounds, he goes to stop the clock with 16, and that's the fourth catch by Jamie Jarman.
And with the wind in his back, I mean, heck, into the wind, they got 149 to distance. They probably only need about 13, 14 more yards to be able to try a long field goal here. Obviously, they'd like more. Got two plays to get into field goal range here, and you have two timeouts to work with.
8-3 is the score. Delaware, two field goals and a safety to get to 8. Jefferson is the running back. Trips to the right side. Papali, Jarman, and Cherry. Scarf to the left. Walker going to throw the football. Has all day. A spiral caught by Papali inside DSU territory at the 32. Down he goes. The tackle was made by Wilcher, and Delaware will take their second timeout.
Like the patience that time from Walker. Find the pocket a little bit. Just let Papali find the window in the zone. Don't throw that too soon when he was still amongst traffic. And then Vinny catching the football. You know, he had troubles with drops as well. We always talk about Jamie Jarman. Now, limited playing time, obviously, suffered the injury in that William and Mary game last year on a hustle play, by the way, trying to chase down on that pick six.
Something his dad, I'm sure, would appreciate.
Yeah, exactly. But good to see him back. Two catches, sure-handed, and most impressively there from Walker in a spot where he thought, how aggressive does Delaware want to be? Well, so far the answer for Danny Rocco is very aggressive. I mean, from the three, he thought maybe two runs to try to punch it in. They throw on third and goal. Here, less than 25 seconds left in the half on your own side of the field. Run a couple of timeouts. Let's try to throw the ball and get into field goal range. And Walker made him look pretty smart this time after it didn't work out on the first try.
9 seconds remaining in the first half. Delaware a five-point lead at the DSU 32-yard line. Trips to the left side. And it's Walker. sets his feet, throws low, and it bounces at the feet of Charles Scarf. His feet were at around the 25-yard line. So now with 5 seconds left, do you have the field goal range at this point? Or at least Jake Roth is going to come on and give it a try, most likely.
Yeah, I think you got to do it.
Mercy Rago.
They had the distance from 49 going into the wind. This one's winding back, and it was blowing a good 10 to 15 miles an hour.
Rago went out, and then he'll come back to the sidelines. We'll see Jake Roth, who missed from 49. And this one going to be from 49 again. Kick is up, has a distance again. Wide again to the left for Jake Roth, and that's how the first half will end. 8-3 is the score after a half an hour of football. Delaware up on Delaware State.
Touchback.
Is there any at all, excuse me, ran a couple of plays for DSU. The surprise was Jack McDaniels coming in, all region in Virginia, but he's done a pretty good job for this football team. We'll see him start the second half as well.
He's been efficient. Hasn't been given many opportunities. We'll see if Kenny Carter, now that he survived the first half, gets a tad more aggressive, especially after that final drive in the opening half.
Empty set. Now they'll send a wide receiver in motion. That's West. The throw is to West, and it was batted down. Pass was backwards, but I believe caught. Anthony Jackson on the tackle. It's on the far side of the field.
I couldn't tell if he caught the ball or not, but
he was diving for it backwards. You watch the replay on the big screen here.
He trapped it. It looked like it didn't matter, though, because it's a backwards pass, so it's a fumble if he doesn't bring that one in.
He picked it up. Loss of six, not the way they wanted to start the second half for the Hornets. Second down, 16, ball on the 19-yard line. A lot of motion in the backfield as they hand it off to the running back, Anthony Jackson, again in on the tackle as the runner got to the 23-yard line.
The one thing that Delaware State has pretty consistently done, with the exception of the one drive where they had any success, where they went vertically, a lot of east and west stuff. Just don't see how that's going to go well against this Delaware defense. Their specialty is pursuit, speed, athleticism, pretty much at every position.
Mike Waters, their star running back, only negative 3 yards in that first half. Third and 13 down goes McDaniels. It was Nichols who got there first. And the senior captain makes it fourth down for DSU.
Well, you're going to run a 3-4 set, three down linemen. You got to get some push in from the middle in passing situations. That's a fantastic job. Just a bull rush and move the offensive lineman back. And Nichols flexed the muscles afterwards. That was pure strength from the middle.
I complain about DSU's jerseys. Delaware's not the easiest to see.
Those numbers.
Romo Martinez hit the punt on fourth down and 19. Jarman back to return. Won't get a chance to do so, but Delaware going to start in DSU territory as it's down at the 46-yard line. That's a 30-yard punt by Romo Martinez. Rock Nichols got there to down it, and we'll see the Delaware offense come out after we take a break. Here, PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 8, Del State 3.
Whether you're a morning person or simply it's not your thing, maybe you're the type that doesn't take it that seriously, or you're that person who just makes everyone's morning brighter. There's a McDonald's for every morning.
Enjoy a sausage burrito for $1 or a sausage McGriddle sandwich for $2. Pair it with any size freshly brewed McCafe hot coffee for $1.
Welcome back to Delaware Stadium, where the Hens will get their first look on offense to start this second half. Again, the yards were there for Delaware. The drives were there for Delaware in that first half, but some critical mistakes in the red zone forced the Hens to only tally 21 and 25-yard field goals from Frank Rago, and now a chance to start in DSU territory.
That's a big short field here, Scott. I mean, every opportunity presented in front of the Hens, and you have a chance to wipe away a lot of the bitter taste from those little mistakes. And Danny Rocco, blatantly honest there at halftime, we have to execute better. And I would imagine he discussed that exact concept with his team. We'll see if they were able to clean it up in 20 minutes.
Walker waiting for the signal, and he'll run things on offense, starting at the DSU 46-yard line. Talks to his running back, Jefferson, behind him. Feet at midfield for Walker. And on the choice, he'll give it to Jefferson. Lead blocker gets him to the 35-yard line, enough for the first down. And again, Delaware with big first down chunks.
Well, Jake Trump was out in front. He was looking for somebody to block, but his mates did too good a job. There was nobody there. And it was actually pursuit for the backside that tackled Thomas Jefferson. I mean, he's out there ready to block somebody and couldn't find anybody. That's a great job up front from UD.
First and 10, 8-3, the lead for Delaware with the football at the Hornet 35. Shotgun snap awaits Joe Walker. He gets it. They'll run the football to the right side. A gap gets Jefferson to the 31-yard line, tackled from behind. It was Kevin Perry with the tackle.
Fantastic effort by UD's offensive line. Again, three different Hornet bodies lying on the ground. You get your guy off his feet, you're going to have success running the football. And again, Jefferson just one broken tackle away from a big hitter there. Instead, he'll settle for five on first down.
Single back Jefferson behind Walker. Second down and six at the DSU 31-yard line. Kerr with the football in his hands, and he's going to snap it to Joe Walker. Quick give is to Jefferson. Can't break through to the outside as Cavacanti came in with the tackle at the 30.
That's a failure game. Yeah. He just does not miss tackles. Remember, that was a big issue for Delaware State a season ago in this matchup, and as a whole, they were in position to make stops, and three or four just dead-to-right arm tackle tries that went awry that turned into long touchdown runs. Tonight, guys like Cavacante have really cleaned it up, and Atwater's defense has been in the mix of it as well.
Double tight end set on third down and five for the DSU 30-yard line. Single back Thomas Jefferson, two wide receivers, Jarman and Cherry, to the left side as Walker tries to roll that way. Gets past the defender. Now he's in trouble, and he's going to be brought down back at the 40-yard line. Tackle made by Malik Harris, the all-CAA, or all-MEAC linebacker.
Farinelli just missed on the block. Backside there. They go naked. Delaware State anticipated. Stayed at home. Farinelli was in position and just could not find the angle to protect Walker. And that's the second or third time where he's had to really abandon trying to survey the field and just kind of run for his life to buy himself some time.
So Delaware starts in DSU territory, but will have to punt. Fourth and 15 after the loss. Ball back at the 40. And we'll see Nick Pritchard for just the second time today. The transfer from Maryland. Back to return Fatu Suagadanet, who leads DSU in receiving. It's a high one. It's going to bounce. In, believe he got that to bounce right at the 3-yard line. Beautiful placement by Pritchard. It was so high, I lost it in the air. I can imagine what Suagadanet was doing. A 37-yard punt by Pritchard. He has had two beauties in his debut.
And using the coffin corner there, you gotta love that. Didn't just try to put it straight up in the air. Used the sideline to his advantage.
And we'll take a timeout before DSU's offense comes out. 8-3, that's your PNC Bank timeout score on WDSD.
The official bird of Delaware isn't red. It's not green or purple. It's blue. Coincidence? We think not. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware. This blue hen does not need to see a podiatrist. But if he did, waiting for a referral might get his feathers in a bunch. And he wouldn't like that one bit. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware.
We'll be right back. Again, Dell State in dangerous territory as we get back to action. They'll start first and 10 from their own 3-yard line. Delaware had a safety earlier in the contest with a Cam Kitchen sack. 10:29 remaining in the third quarter, and Delaware up 8-3.
From Delaware State, it's one of two things here. It is either a quick hitter up the middle to try to get some real estate or play action and a vertical shot. They tried a slow-developing lateral run and a shot out of their own goal line last time, and it cost them 2 points.
Empty backfield for the freshman QB, and now Waters is a single back in the end zone. They go to Waters. He gets out of the end zone, gets a push from his offensive line to the 5, so a little bit of space, maybe to the 6 on second down coming up.
Rugby scrum there in the middle, and that's exactly, if you're Delaware State, what you're looking for. Nichols did a good job to kind of hold his ground. He had half the offensive line try to push him back, but now you got yourself a little breathing room.
Waters again the back. Here's McDaniel. Second and 7. They'll get to the 6-yard line in his own territory. Drops back, throws, pass caught at the 11, dragged backwards, but they'll mark forward progress at the 11. The tackle made by Charles Bell is 4.
It's a 3-step drop. My man hit his back foot and held the football in the end zone. That is a dangerous play that time from McDaniels, but he got to his arm strength and just kind of shot it through a tight gap.
Third down and 1 for DSU. They struggled on third down, just 1 of 6. Offset eye, will go to the back. Waters, enough push to get out to the 15 and pick up the first down. Colby Reeder in on the tackle, the redshirt freshman. Highly anticipated debut today for Colby Reeder.
Colby Reeder is learning a new position in his 3-4 defense at outside linebacker. It's very important for him to keep his leverage. Now he's going to be asked to do a lot of different things, and fortunately he's capable of doing most of them.
He's that cat outside linebacker in this 3-4 scheme. First and 10 for the 15. Screen pass from behind Selby. It goes out of bounds, and I believe if that stayed in bounds, it would have been live. Another backwards pass, but it rolls out of bounds on the DSU sideline.
Delaware State is in this football game in spite of its coaching staff, I feel like, sometimes. That is the second time now inside their own 20-yard line throwing a backwards pass. That's about as high a risk as you could possibly come up with. That was absolute near disaster. Bad break for the Blue Rocks, or for the Blue Hens, and it bounced out of bounds. First time I did that tonight.
But a lot of baseball games you announced during the year. Second down and 13 after the backwards pass went out of bounds. McDaniels chopping his feet, throwing deep, cutting back to get it at the 45-yard line is Selby. But will it stick? There is a flag near the sideline.
I think going to go against Delaware. I thought it was going to be a push off, but I think they're going to say Malcolm Brown was holding.
Officials talking things over. Flag thrown where the pass was caught.
Pass interference. Defense. Number 1, 15 yard penalty. Automatic first down.
They called it incomplete. His body hit the sideline before he was able to secure the catch. Officials are not real big on emphatic signals as he bobbled it up in the air and his shoulder was lying on the sideline as he came down with it. But I thought he shoved Brown by as he stopped for the football on the replay. A little bit of a grab of the jersey there for Malcolm Brown and a costly penalty for Delaware.
It's only the third penalty of the day for Delaware. Delaware led the nation last year in fewest penalties by a team. That penalty makes it first down and 10, an 8-3 lead for Delaware. Screen pass, dropped by Sua, got it. That was dangerous because Jackson was in the area, and so was Nigel Hill, the redshirt freshman. That came off Gaudinette's hands. If it floated a little bit longer, Hill would have had a pick 6.
It seems every time Del State tries to get the ball up the field through the air, they've had some good things happen. Every time they've tried to go wide, quick hitters, disaster strikes, that's right into the strength of this Delaware defense. That time the ball popped up in the air, very nearly intercepted on the ricochet.
8:37. Third quarter action, 8-3, Delaware's lead. Bell showing some blitz. He gets picked up, but another Blue Hen wasn't. Up in the pocket goes McDaniels. He gets cracked by Colby Reeder. Helmet flies off. Flags are thrown at the 30.
That's going to be targeting, and you're going to lose Reeder probably for the rest of this game and the first half of the next game. And that's unfortunate because it was a late decision to slide, but he went with that head ducked, and most of the time that's the action that'll get you called by the official. It's such a penal foul. But they're trying to make the game safer.
Officials talking it over, want to get it right, because here we go.
Personal foul, targeting, defense. Number four, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down. The previous play is under review.
Now it's an automatic review. They can do one of two things here. They can take away the ejection. They can also take away the personal foul. I don't think they're going to do either. That hurts if you're Delaware, because not only is Reeder gone the rest of this game, he does not get to play the first half against Virginia Tech next week. Young guy getting his feet wet in college football. You want him to get as many reps as you can. It's an air of effort, but you always have to be careful lowering your head, especially when hitting a quarterback. It was a late slide, and it's really tough. I understand why defenders get so frustrated, because when a guy slides that late on you, you kind of got to try to go get him, but you also got to keep your head up, because they're really trying to legislate that out of the game.
And Troy Reeder, Colby Reeder, the Reeder family, the bloodlines run deep at Delaware. We're going to, if this stays, we won't see Colby the rest of the game, like Matt mentioned. Corey has more on the Reeder family lineage here at Delaware.
Well, you're certainly right, Scott. Colby and Troy making their first start side by side here tonight in the opener. But their father, Dan, a former standout runner here with the Blue Hens as a fullback from 1982 to 1984 under Tubby Raymond. But with Dan still supporting the Blue Hens program after his playing days, the Reeder siblings certainly know what Delaware football is all about. They have come to games since they were siblings, and Colby realized the support from the fans and the culture surrounding this Blue Hens football program is certainly something that he wanted to be a part of.
Thank you very much, Corey. And unfortunately for the Hens and Hens fans and that Reeder family, Colby's night going to be cut short a bit as he'll be escorted towards the locker room as the call does stand for targeting.
I love, though, the brother's reaction as he gave the emphatic dismissive wave there after they said that the play stands on the field. Those guys, you know, you have your teammates' backs. That's part of the brotherhood of being on a football team. But there's a little something extra of having your back when it's your actual brother on your football
team.
That's
why they did it. Troy coming over from Penn State, Colby with FBS offers. They wanted to play together. They won't for the rest of the second half as a 15-yard penalty makes it first and 10, the DSU 46. Waters, no room to run as I believe Bell got there first to the outside. Several other blue jerseys, including Troy Reeder, making the stop for his brother.
How many times have we seen Reeder and Bell tonight just swarming the ball carriers? They have played amongst the Delaware defense. It really has had a very strong evening. Statistically, they've held Delaware State to negative rushing yards tonight. They have, I think, stood out above all the rest. Now Nichols and Kitchen have made their claim as well, but those two guys are everywhere.
McDaniels in shotgun form on second down and 13. Looking for a target, throws it wide to the sideline of Delaware, incomplete to Sua Gadanet.
Good job by Jackson. Got his depth that time. That pass was supposed to be almost immediately in the flat to Sua Gadanet. And Jackson made it string a little bit further, which is a tougher throw. You got to put a little extra mustard on it to make sure nobody's breaking on it from the outside. And as a result, it just got away from McDaniels. Getting your depth, something that sometimes Delaware struggled with a season ago, so critical, the spacing of the defense, and it really paid off there and sends Delaware State into a third and long.
Third down, 13 for DSU. They're 2 of 7 on third down. Pressure coming. McDaniels throws it down the sideline. Selby can't get under it again. Brown in excellent coverage. The safety, Jones, coming over for help, and it falls incomplete.
I think a lot of the credit there goes to Big Cam Kitchen. What a swim move he put on as he showed outside, ducked inside, and was in the grill of McDaniels as he let that football go. I think he had to throw it a half count sooner than he wanted to, and I think that the pressure coming right in his face forced a little bit more of an inaccurate pass than otherwise he would have made.
Fourth down and 13. Romo Martinez on to punt this one away from the 43. Jarman going to let it bounce. It sticks at the 27-yard line. Rolls up just a yard to the 28. And Romo Martinez, another punt That leads to Delaware possession, 29 yards that time for DSU's punter. 7:26 remaining in the third quarter. And again, Delaware's offense back out on the field looking for some points. Looking to get in that end zone.
Poor Roma Martinez is watching his Omiak candidacy go up in flames here in the second and third quarter. He's been putting into a stiff wind. He's trying to go with a line drive. He's just not getting any roll whatsoever. The ball is almost backing up on him as it hits. And Delaware, that's another part of the concern here. They have had fantastic field position, just haven't taken advantage. Here, average field position, but it could have been much worse after Del State strung together a few first downs.
A couple penalty-aided first downs for DSU, but they do punt. Delaware on the field to start. Ball on their own 27 with Kareem Williams. Not much room as she goes up the gut. Picks up the yard to the 29-yard line. Second and nine coming up with an 8-3 lead for the Hens.
Have not had a ton of success downhill between the tackles. When they've been able to run the ball that direction, they've kind of had to make something happen with a cut left or a jump cut from Thomas Jefferson. It hasn't been the dominance physically that maybe expected against a younger and a little bit undersized Delaware State defensive front. Although, credit the Hornets, they have really done a good job up there.
Second down and seven. They gave 3 yards for Williams. I guess initial contact came at around the 30-yard line. So play action now on second down. Walker down the field. Jarman had a step. It was high off the hands of Jarman. But with him, step for step, was Nigel Bynum, the sophomore, and it falls incomplete.
Boy, Jarman just keeps getting better and better at those routes. Again, step to the outside, and that post, he is uber quick to get a step on the defender. Now, that was a smaller window throw for Joe Walker. Again, maybe a little bit more air under that football, though, to give Jarman a chance to go up and get it. That was a bullet. It wasn't a huge window, and you threw it where there was no chance of it being intercepted, which is a positive. That gives you a guy a bit more of a chance.
Jarman has 4 catches today. Couldn't haul in his fifth, so third down and seven for Delaware at their own 30. Play action again. Walker looking, throwing high. No one in the area. Jarman was the intended target, but a quick three and out that time for Delaware.
They had Scarf right near the sticks. Now, they were working a two-man combination with Cherry going vertically and Jarman underneath that intermediate route. And I think Walker kind of locked on Jarman for the first time we saw him kind of predetermine the throw. He's done a really good job of avoiding that tonight. Wasn't his most accurate toss. There really wasn't anybody open either outside of Scarf who he missed.
Sua got a net back to return. Nick Pritchard looked good today punting the football. This will be his third punt of the evening on fourth down and seven from the DSU 30. Gets this one away, and this one another high spiraling punt. Backpedaling to Sua got net. He dropped it. Ball's loose. He runs under it at the 21-yard line. Dangerous play by Sua Gatinet. Hens were coming to get it, but he fell on the football. A 51-yard punt by the Maryland transfer. Impressive stuff from Nick Pritchard today.
But, Scott, those are the plays you got to find a way to make. I mean, that ball was high up in the air. He kicked it a long way, but I don't think he outkicked his coverage. Now, it took a bad bounce on Delaware. It hopped to the left, and everybody was expecting because Delaware State had a right return set up. But, I mean, the opportunities have been there right in front of UD, and these are the type of games where the longer this one goes where Delaware State hangs around. You're now one play away from trailing as we're deep into the third quarter. These are the type of games, if you're not careful, despite dominating it statistically the whole way, you end up losing.
McDaniel's out with his offense on first and 10 from his own 22. An 8-3 lead for Delaware. DSU with the football. Stepping up in the pocket. McDaniel's avoiding the sack. Has a man open at the 40, but I believe he skipped it to him. He caught the football. He got low for that one. And again, McDaniels using his feet to buy himself some time, and Jordan Hanna with an excellent reception.
Yeah, he did not get his full body underneath that throw, but that was a heck of an effort by Hanna to come back, help his quarterback out on this scramble drill, and then go down and secure that catch. He had to really cradle that one as it was underthrown by a good 2-3 yards.
5:56 and ticking, third quarter action. First and 10, ball on the 39 after the pickup by DSU on first down. In motion goes the back, and they'll go to Elaine, who picks up maybe 3 to the outside right.
Good job by Reader to play his assignment that time. They were trying to show option out action to the edge. Hanna coming wide, but they had the outside linebacker over there, Harley, to take it away, and Reader did his job.
Second down and 7 for DSU. Ball on their own 42-yard line. And a screen pass thrown and caught to Suaganat. He gets past Hill with a shimmy move up towards midfield, down at the 49-yard line. And believe that'll be enough for the first down as some communication, and now they'll move to 6. Suaganat got right to that marker. He's having an impressive day, Suaganat, the sophomore from Honolulu.
He's shifty. There's no doubt about it. You got to make sure you come up out of control there, too, if you're the Delaware defense. You stop him for 4 or 5 yards, that's okay. You don't have to make every stop up near the line of scrimmage. You got a little out of control.
That was a freshman Hill who missed him. First and 10, ball near midfield. And it'll be McDaniel running the QB choice. He's knocked as he gets into Delaware territory. It was Buck Jones who came in for the stop.
A little read option that time, and a good decision to pull it back by McDaniels. Kind of got to go a little bit more up the field that time. Tried to run laterally, and Jones is just too fast. I mean, it looked like when he kept it, he had a step. Jones is going to close that ground in a hurry, which he did, and so it's a short game. But they're on the right side of the field if you're Delaware State trying to drive for the lead.
Ends defending in their own territory now as DSU continues this drive, trying to get down the field. A lane slips, one would be tackler. Ball comes loose. Delaware says they have it at the 44. And it's Blue Hens football, a turnover by the Hornets. I believe that's big Cam Kitchen who came up with the football. He had the safety earlier today, and now a fumble recovery for the junior from Lawrenceville, New Jersey.
Jalen Kindle, the big hit throw to knock it free, and then big Cam Kitchen almost deflated it as he fell on top of it, center of the field, and that's the lift that you were looking for desperately if you were Delaware. What a hit by Kendall as he got his shoulder directly on that football to pop it free.
How about Kendall taking advantage of some opportunities? He comes in for Colby Reeder. No starts last year as a junior. He started all 11 games as a sophomore. A big hit knocking it loose. Let's see if the Hens can't use this momentum as Williams comes in as the running back. And a signal now on the field.
They're going to review it. But it sure looked like when we saw it live that the ball popped out. On the replay, there was a lot of traffic between the angle we saw of the ball carrier's knee. So I'm not sure if he was up or not, but it looked like that ball came through.
As they take a look, let me tell you, the WDSC Blue Hens Radio is once again looking sharp thanks to Unique Impressions on Main Street. They outfit us with our WDSC Adidas gear, including our new polos the team is wearing today. The best quality of embroidery you will find. It's so easy to work with. They take the time to go over every detail and have certainly been committed to our customer service. Unique Impressions, custom screen printing, logo embroidery, and promo products for your company and organization. Visit uniqueonline.com.
It's a really big decision in this game. I'm putting the replay up on the big board right now, so we don't really have any more information for you. We'll have to wait on the decision from the officials. But, you know, if Delaware State, if this gets overturned, they still have possession. It'll be a big momentum swing back in their direction on the plus side of the field, down by 5. Meanwhile, if it is a fumble, defense has provided another short field, and it's time for UD to finally take advantage of one of them.
Take a look at some of the stats so far in the ball game. Joe Walker, 9 of 18, throwing 116 yards. McDaniels, his counterpart for DSU, sharp in his debut. 8 of 13 for 13 yards. Walker does have the one interception. Elaine leads DSU in rushing, 8 carries for 20 yards. Delaware led by Thomas Jefferson, 15 carries, 83 yards. Greg Williams, 10 for 46. Jarman, 4 catches for 36 yards. And now we'll hear from the official what they saw. He can get his mic on.
The ruling on the field stands. First down, University of Delaware.
Well, as we mentioned, a lot of traffic between the ball carrier and the camera angle, so they couldn't get a conclusive view. That's okay with Delaware, because when the call is in your direction, not conclusive works just as well. And here it is, short field, right on the edge of starting in Delaware State territory. The whole third quarter has been flipped on Delaware's side of the field. They haven't been able to cash in yet.
First and 10 from their own 45-yard line after the fumble recovery by Cam Kitchen, who's having a heck of a start to 2017. Pass is thrown and caught at midfield by Cherry. He spins to his left, gets to the sideline, picks up the first down, and out of bounds you go. Have a Cathy in on the tackle.
Good sure-handed catch by Cherry. Nice timing on the throw from Walker. Another good job by Danny Jarman, though. It's a little rubber out there that time, and he was able to set the pick, but without using his body. Remember how many times Danny Jarman, his first 2 years, got called for offensive pass interference? He's figured it out. We're really seeing this kid mature in front of our eyes.
8-3, Delaware leads. 3:48, third quarter. Delaware into DSU territory. Ball at the 41. It's Williams, has blockers to the left, sprinting to the 31-yard line, and another first down pickup. It was Heslop who stopped him, but what a push by that offensive line. Trump and Lutz on the left side.
It was a little counteraction as well, which got Williams an extra step to the outside, but had multiple blockers out in front, which is a great sign that you just beat them at the line of scrimmage.
3:22 and ticking, third quarter. Hens trying to get in the end zone for the first time as they just got the football back thanks to a fumble recovery by Cam Kitchen. It was Kendall who knocked it out. Running back is Williams. To the right of Walker is the captain, Yoakum. Williams picks up a blitzer. Walker throwing downfield high over the head and out of bounds. Jarman was the target at the 5. He had to hurry that time.
Yes, and good coverage from Garnier Wilkins, who stuck with Jarman and really gave no window where Walker could put that football. Great blitz pickup pulled by Williams. I thought when that ball was snapped, that was going to be a sack. And Williams really sacrificed his body a little bit to step in there and give Walker at least enough time to stay on schedule and get rid of the football for the incompletion.
Two wide receivers to the right on second down and 10. Delaware, DSU territory at the 31. Here comes another blitz. Walker throwing to the right side, pass off the hands and nearly intercepted by Kewan Selby. He has one, almost had another. If he caught that one, DSU would have had themselves a lead because he would have gone 70 yards for the score.
The ball was a little out in front of Cherry, but you got to find a way to make your wide receiver, your quarterback, right. And the ball bounces straight up in the air, and if that ball is intercepted, Selby's still running. The Delaware native, he could have run all the way back to St. George. I mean, that would have been no way Delaware was catching him. That would have been a game changer. Big break for UD.
Big play here for Delaware. They get good field position. It's third down and 10 in Delaware State territory, up by 5. Trips to the right side. 2:59 to play in the third quarter. Walker looking to throw. Pressure is coming. He eludes it to the right side. Running. Avoids Heslop. Throws towards the end zone. Coming back to get it is Deontay Cherry. And Delaware finds the end zone for the first time in 2017. A 31-yard pass from Walker to Deontay.
What a bullet from Walker. And what an adjustment back to the football by Deontay Cherry. Runs the length of the end line there in the end zone. And that's the beauty of having a strong arm quarterback, as Walker breaks contain 40 yards up the field. You would think if you're the defender, you can relax there. No, Walker slings one, and Cherry is able to make a quick step forward at the last second to get position, and it hit him right in the chest. Great pitch and catch.
All around, a wonderful play by the Blue Hens, and they have a 14-3 lead. Extra point coming on. Pritchard holds. Rago backs it through. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 15, DSU 3, 2:48 remaining in the third.
The best part about playing in the CAA.
The best part about playing in the CAA is
by far the competition.
All the competition.
Each week, you never know what's going to happen.
We've had multiple teams win national championships.
James Madison, Kings of the FCS.
We got a lot of great players in this league who can make a play anytime.
When you have to prepare for the CAA teams each and every week, that's what prepares you for playoffs. I think that's what makes it the most dominant conference.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing.
It's not too big, not too small.
Looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
5 plays, 55 yards. That's the Acura Buick GMC drive summary as Walker found Cherry in the end zone. A 31-yard strike. It was a bullet thrown by Joe Walker, and Cherry came back to get it. First score in the end zone of the season for Delaware, and Rolfe gets another kick with that wind to his back. He loves it. A touchback. 15-3 is the count. 2:48 remaining in the third quarter as DSU gets the football. Hens I said it before the snap, a big third down there would have taken a first, but I'll take a touchdown, that's for sure. You felt like the Hens needed a touchdown on that drive.
Well, the nice part about what we have seen tonight, third and long has not been a death sentence for Delaware. The offense the last two seasons, if it was third and more than five, that's always kind of a tough spot for an offense. But they were hitting at like a 10-15% clip in those situations. It's just impossible to sustain any offense that way. Tonight, 5 of 11 on third down. Three of the conversions have been third and more than five. That's a really good sign for this team. And finally, one came with a field tilted in their direction. They still haven't scored a touchdown from the red zone, but you'll take it when it comes outside the red zone as well.
2:48 to begin this drive in the third quarter by McDaniels, who gets it to the back, Mike Waters. And all MEAC selection a season ago, gets across the 25 up to the 27. And Bell again in on the stop, the two-time captain Charles Bell, the senior from Conestoga, Pennsylvania. He led the team with 94 tackles a season ago. Such an exciting linebacker core. Delaware has 2:28 ticking now as McDaniels will go. Trips to the right side. DSU going a little faster, now down 15-3. Empty backfield. Waters to the left. McDaniels talking with him. Screen pass comes. Waters has to make a move. Does so. Passed, I believe, Tenney out of Woosie. Armin Ware makes the tackle at the 37-yard line. That's enough for the first down. Good move by the sophomore back.
Now you got to force the play back to your help. Step inside and allowed an escape to the edge. Great pursuit by Ware. That might have been a much bigger play. Danny Rocco immediately stepping out to Adewuzie, coaching him on the field there to not make that mistake again.
Trips again to the far side, right in motion. This time goes Waters, and they'll give him the football with some room to operate at the 40 to the 41-yard line. And Harley comes in and makes the tackle.
Jordan Pan is not a big guy, and Ray Jones came flying in kamikaze style. Looked like it was going to be a big collision, and it was a big collision, but he never got to the ball carrier. Hanna really did a nice job to stick his head in there to slow up Jones, which is what got Dell State the edge there. Keeps him in a second advantage.
Lane in as the running back on second down and five on the 42-yard line of DSU, down 15-3. They'll go to Lane, looking for some space, and he can't find anything. It was Bilal Nichols who got in the way. John Nassib was there as well, and I believe Sal Morrow in on the tackle.
Here's where Delaware State, though, the game plan starting to run out of time to work. They clearly came in with the idea of shorten the game, bend, but don't break defensively. But now you're down to under 16 minutes to go and trailing by two touchdowns. You're going to have to start to take some chances.
Third and five for DSU. Under a minute, third quarter. Ends up 15-3. McDaniels, pressure coming, gets it away. Adderley has a pass breakup, but he couldn't hold it. He had a good look at an interception. Stepped right in front of Jordan Hanna. But the ball fell to the turf. And it'll be fourth down and five.
Nice to have a safety with corner skills.
Yeah.
Adderley absolutely read that and jumped it second time. We've seen a hand jump around. Unfortunately, neither time has it resulted in an interception. One, a misfire that ended up being a good break for Delaware State. And that time, just a drop. Well, Adderley's going to see that one in his sleep. He had a chance, and he kept his footing to go because there was nobody in front of him between he and the end zone.
Adderley, one of many tied last year with two interceptions to lead the team. He did have six passes defended. Here comes a fake on fourth down. They're going to pick up the first as they went right to the running back, or to the punter, Fidel Romo Martinez. Caught us napping, caught Delaware napping as well as the ball goes into Delaware territory. And the conversion is made. Why not if you're Delaware State?
Figure out what happened there. You're right, it was the punter, but it snapped to the up man, or at least it sure looked like it did. I'm not sure if they had two kickers out there or what went off.
They also have Devin Adams listed as 32.
They can't have two guys with the same number on the field at the same time. That's an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty.
Regardless, 15 seconds ticking away on this third quarter clock, and a surprise play extends the drive by DSU. Under center goes McDaniel. Give his to Elaine. Finds Elaine. Breaking at the 30. Watson fair. Strips it loose. Delaware picks it up. Armin Ware falls on the football, and Delaware gets it back.
That is a huge play. Sudden change. Dell State got a quick hitter to the outside and just not giving up on the play. Armin Ware, we talked about it on that quick pass to the outside where he chased it down from behind. Well, this time, just run to the football and good things will happen. And Ware's certainly proving that out.
They're going to take a look at it. And we're going to take a timeout as they do. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Blue Hens 15, Hornets 3.
Down to our last two teams in the 12 teams in 12 day series.
Into the post to Nick Harrison.
We've all been there.
Can't even see the score.
Oh my God.
Trying to watch the game on that tiny screen. It's time to watch sports the way they were meant to be watched. On this, in high definition. You can now watch all your favorite teams and players on the big screen for free. With CAA.TV, you'll never miss a moment. Take back the living room by searching CAA on your device.
Of the third quarter brought us to the timeout. They review every fumble. That one was a clear one. Knocked out by Justin Watson and picked up by Armand Ware. So back-to-back fumbles forced and recovered by the Delaware defense. And Corey, that's something you talked about in the pregame.
Yeah, absolutely. Last year, the Blue Hens forced 6 turnovers against the Hornets. But in conference play, they were only able to get 13 takeaways. We talked about that new defense implemented by Coach Rocco, the 3-4. Wanted to see if they had an understanding of it. Certainly seems like that defense is rearing to go here in the second half with those big 2 turnovers.
And if you think you're the Blue Hens' number one fan, stop into any of the 80 businesses in People's Plaza and register to be the People's Plaza fan of the game, like this week's winner, Rich Tralla, who has won a UD Blue Hens prize pack.
Hustle is a beautiful thing. Both Justin Watson and Armand Ware certainly showed it off and were rewarded that time. And I just love the mental toughness of this Delaware defense that they put on display. I played a dominant the first 35, 37 minutes as you could possibly play outside of 2 plays on that last drive in the first half where they got themselves in a little bit of harm's way. And even then, they were able to stiff it at the 1-yard line and hold Del State to a field goal. Here, give up a big punt and an immediate misdirection counter the other way. After the big punt, it looks like it's going for a big play. These guys just keep the motor going and playing to the whistle. And if you're Danny Rocco, I mean, you're going to be really happy when you look back at that on film. I mean, it's one thing to create a turnover. It's another thing when you're chasing down a play from behind to do it.
2 tight ends, single back to start the fourth quarter. 1st and 10 from their own 16. It's Kareem Williams running to the left side behind Mario Farinella. Gets up to the 21-yard line. Pick up the 5. 2nd and 5 coming up.
An uneven performance from the offense today, obviously. I mean, 15 points on the board, but a lot of positives to draw in terms of how they moved it. Here's where you'd like to see them run one of those, you know, 5-minute offense where you take your time between plays, you know, one of those 15, 18 play drives where you finish it off with an end zone. With the way this offense is built, they should be in good position to do that type of thing. They struggled with it, though, a year ago.
Walker in shotgun on 2nd down and 5. Williams with him. Williams again, this time to the right. Speedy to the right side. A stiff arm helps him get up to the 24-yard line, pushed out of bounds. I believe just shy of that 1st down marker, the push out by Cameron Rogers.
Yeah, but 3rd and 2, you can live with that if you're Delaware. I like the way that Williams didn't just run dead laterally. He angled it up the field. And that's the thing. You see a lot of backs where they just run straight along the line of scrimmage, never pick up any space, and the defense just chases him down. Williams did a good job to turn it up, and now 3rd and 2, everything's at your disposal.
They were 5 of 11 on 3rd downs tonight. 2 yards needed from their own 24-yard line, up 15-3, and right up the gut, Williams into a tackler, enough strength to get him the 1st down.
Football's a game of leverage. Williams got low, and that was what picked him up the 1st down. Big hit, though, at the point of impact. The collision came with the deep tackle.
Jacob Jones, I believe, was the one at least slow to get up. We'll keep an eye on him.
I'm a little surprised they didn't stop the game and force him out. The officials had that in their power. That was a big collision. He staggered back a little bit there.
Freshman package in, Coleman and Pitts are the wide receivers for Delaware on 1st down and 10. They'll give it to the runner, Thomas Jefferson, dancing, looking for some space, and he gets up to the 29-yard line, a 5-yard pickup and the tackle made again by Brian Cavacante, who's having a good debut for the Hornets. 12:56 and ticking here in the fourth quarter. Delaware can take their time, run the football, 15-3 lead. Scoreboard showing 4th-and-2. It's second down and about 8. Some confusion, perhaps.
It's opening day for the scoreboard guys, too.
Had to check the sticks to make sure I had it right. As Jefferson is the runner, Yoakum next to Joe Walker on 2nd-and-8. They'll fake the give to the running back. Walker hit as he throws a dart off the hands of Scarf. Went to jump to get it, but catchable at midfield. And Scarf kind of tapping his chest, looking back at the quarterback, saying, I should have had that one.
Hey, anytime a wide receiver gets his hands on the football, or a tight end, in this case, Scarf, he's going to say that. That was really the first ball where Walker really missed, but his defense had some pressure at his feet. I don't think he got a full step into that toss. Just a little bit high, a little bit behind. That was an open target. Walker will probably want that throwback.
It brings up 3rd down and 8. Ends after the turnover picked up by Arvin Ware at their own 29-yard line. They need 8 yards for a first down. Walker awaits a snap. Here's Joe. Has some time. Good blocking up front. Throws it high for Jarman this time. Same spot, midfield. Incomplete.
Walker got off to that hot start. He was 3 of his first 3. Since then, 8 of his last 20 attempts. Now, a couple of drops certainly haven't helped the cause. There's been some pressure at his feet. But the one thing that we talked about that you need to see from Joe Walker, consistency. 30-year starter at quarterback. This isn't the guy making his first or second start. There are positives to build on tonight, but just got to make sure he continues to throw the ball accurately.
11 of 24. Here's Pritchard. High punt. Shorter than his first two, but he'll get a roll from the 40 down to the 35-yard line in Delaware State territory. 36-yard punt. And we'll take a timeout before DSU gets their offense back on the field. Your PNC Bank timeout score. Delaware 15, Del State 3. 12:09 to go for Delaware Stadium.
Whether you're a morning person or simply it's not your thing, maybe you're the type that doesn't take it that seriously. Or you're that person who just makes everyone's morning brighter. There's a McDonald's for every morning.
Enjoy a sausage burrito for $1 or a sausage McGriddle sandwich for $2. Pair it with any size freshly brewed McCafe hot coffee for $1.
The official bird of Delaware isn't red. It's not green or purple. It's blue. Coincidence? We think not. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware. This blue hen does not need to see a podiatrist. But if he did, waiting for a referral might get his feathers in a bunch. And he wouldn't like that one bit. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware.
Hornets about to come out on offense, 15-3. Delaware with the lead, 12:09 to play. And want to give notice to a great cause going on in an organization that Matt works for, the Women's of the Blue Rocks. Ian Corey and I know doing great things.
Yeah, we appreciate the Blue Rocks letting Corey and I miss the game tonight to come out here. And this weekend, we are going to try to raise money for the hurricane relief effort. Hurricane Harvey, or Hen, obviously taking such bad things down in Houston. $2 for every box seat or reserve seat purchased online using the promo code RELIEF for games Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. We'll go directly to the Red Cross. We're also going to be raising money inside the ballpark, so we hope that you will help us out. BlueRocks.com.
Great stuff. Nice job, Matt. And now DSU on the field as McDaniels pumps, nowhere to go, down the sideline to his tight end Williams. Arvin Ware, I believe, got a hand in there. How about the hybrid DN linebacker going downfield, staying toe-to-toe with the tight end Isaiah Williams?
3-4 defense, a lot of guys in some new roles running in space that time. Now, the tight end Williams is not exactly a burner. He's more of a blocking tight end. But he had a half step on Ware, and Ware had the quickness to go catch up. And that's pretty good trail technique coverage and head looking back at the football, which allowed him to make a play on it.
Waters is a running back next to McDaniels, a freshman quarterback, getting his first start. And he's got time to throw on 2nd-and-10. Down the field, and it's deflected. Pass looking for Sua, got a net, and I believe Justin Watson, who forced the fumble last time DSU had the football, had a pass break up there, but he's slow to get up. See Dan Watson run onto the field.
I love Dan Watson, but would never like to see him get out there. I think this is his first visit to the field. That was a fantastic play by Watson. Timed it perfectly to play the football, swipe it through and knock that football down. But then it just looked like the receiver kind of curled up on his leg and it got pretzeled just a little bit. And hopefully it's nothing serious because he's an important part of this defense.
Never know exactly what's going on, but we can give some details as to what they might be looking at. Corey, do you have a look at maybe what they're working on?
Yeah, it looks like they're working on his right leg. The air cast is out. They're pumping the air into it. Full medical staff is out for UD. Head coach Danny Rocco has his headset off. He was down on a knee holding his hand on Ware's chest, and Ware was clearly and visibly upset. He was punching at the air, and he knows that he's hurt, and right now it looks like it's his right leg. And it looks like they're bringing a stretcher out now to help him off the field from the far side.
Thank you, Corey. We appreciate your eyes down on the field. It does look like there is a stretcher coming from the far side of the field. Ambulance does have lights on. And going all out, as he has done his whole career, a pass breakup. And the injury has slowed things up.
And now they're going to place him on the stretcher. And a nice show here from the Delaware Stadium faithful. And certainly we're all thinking of Watson. Hope he's feeling much better very soon. We have not had an update lately, but that last check, the one interconference CAA game going on right now. New Hampshire on top of Maine 17-10. That is a really tough way to start your season. A New England rivalry game as they send Watson out and he waves to the fans. Great time to see.
Great to see Justin raise that right arm, wave as you described, and you can hear the fans cheering him on, and your heart just breaks for Justin Watson, who we've gotten to know through the years. A happy-go-lucky guy, a great guy to interview. He's an energy and environmental major. You don't see that major. It's unique. He knows what he wants to do in life, and he's going to be successful whatever he chooses after football. And that's tough to look at. And our hearts go out to, again, his parents, James and Teresa, who are two of our favorite fans. And we just hope the best for Justin Watson. Again, a good sign. He did raise his hand as he was carted off on the field. Play, though, does need to continue here as we're going to get back into action. Both teams coming out of the field now with 11:57 remaining in the ball game, and Delaware up 15-3.
And here's always the tough part. They got to ratchet it back up. And important play for Delaware State. If they want to stay in this game, they've got to convert here. Down by 12 and under 12 minutes to go, a third and long.
Third down and 10 for DSU. They've not fared well on third downs, just 2 of 9 tonight. McDaniels checking back to the sideline for the call. Stands in shotgun form. Waters is the running back to his left. 3 wide receivers, 2 to the far side left. McDaniels looking that way. Hit as he throws, lobs it up. It's short of Sua, got an end. His intended receiver, and it'll be fourth down.
Very slow developing route that time. Gave Malal Nichols all the time in the world to get in there. Big Malal and Cam Hitchin have played a whale of the second half. I mean, they were good in the first half, but they have really stepped it up since intermission. They have lived in the Dell State backfield against both the run and the passer. So they had struggled to get pressure on the passer in that first half. There has been no such struggle since halftime.
DSU faked their last punting attempt. Romo Martinez back to return. We had some mix-up of numbers last time. He wears 9, so we figured it out. They did it. A quick snap. This time won't be the case. But Pally waving for it, and he grabs it back at the 15-yard line. Call it the 14-yard line. 51-yard punt by Romo Martinez. So Delaware with the football back. 15-3 is the score. Clock at 11:34. It's actually ticking during the stoppage. They might have to put some time back up. Or if it went unnoticed, it stopped eventually at 11:32 left to play. So Delaware has the football, has the lead, 15-3. Hens put up 328 yards of offense, just 179 yards for DSU. 30 minutes with the football for Delaware, 18 minutes with the football for the Hornets. Statistically, the categories in favor of Delaware, balanced at 167 on the ground, 161 through the air. But a closer game than we all expected. The Hens weren't able to punch it in many times as we would have liked.
Considering how dominant the first half was statistically, the second half has been much more even. But you never have really felt outside of that one spot where it was 8-3 and Del State stuck its toe into Delaware territory with the football. You just tensed up for a half second there just to make sure nothing weird happened. Delaware's control came from start to finish. There's going to be a lot to work on, but the beauty of between week one and week two is that tends to be where the most improvement happens. We hear that from coaches all the time. Every coach I've ever worked with in game of the football, they love that statement because it's so true. Now you have a tough task though in week two. You got to go down to Blacksburg and take on Virginia Tech. The good news is you get a long rest.
That's right.
Virginia Tech, they got a tough game on Sunday night. They got
back to bruise, that's for sure.
Yeah. So, you know, you worry about next week, but the little things, execution in terms of clean blocks, a couple of missed assignments. Joe Walker showed some flashes. The accuracy has kind of slipped here a little bit in the second half. If they can clean that stuff up, you know, if they're right there for a big dominant performance, you gotta do it. At a certain point, we've talked about this for years. Potential's a great thing. You gotta grab that potential and turn it into result.
See what the Hens can do on this possession. It starts first and 10 for their own 14-yard line. 11:32 to play and a 15-3 lead as Jefferson bounces to the outside and picks up some yardage to the 19-yard line, maybe the 20, a 6-yard pickup on first down, second and 4 coming up.
But, you know, right now, a lot of your thoughts go to Justin Watson. You hope that he's all right. That would be a big blow to lose him back there in that secondary. You know, it's an area where this is a very deep defense, and they're not thin in the secondary, but that's probably the thinnest of the three levels of the deep.
Pitts in as a wide receiver. Coleman in as a wide receiver. We're seeing Kane for the first time behind Joe Walker. Second down and 5. First carry of the career of Kane as he goes to the outside right and picks up enough for the first down. Tackle made by Brock Nichols, his 7th.
They really like this kid. Sussex Tech grad. Comes to Delaware as a junior. Spent the last 2 years at Lackawanna College. 2,000 yards his last year at Sussex Tech. So certainly has had success in the first state. He's one of 39 Delaware natives playing or on the rosters in this game, which is always pretty cool. The two Division I first state programs well represented with first state athletes.
Lackawanna turns them out there as a school. Brian Shore, the offensive player of the year in CAA from Lackawanna, James Madison. First and 10. Kane again stopped at the line of scrimmage, but won't be stopped. Bounces to the outside. After first contact came at the line, he gets all the way out to the 31-yard line and picks up 7. Flag thrown very late after the play.
You know, the kind of pack that Danny Rocco likes looks an awful lot like Kane, and you see why there. The ability to break first contact, to shed it, and just keep plowing forward.
Personal foul, face mask, defense, number 2. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
That's Jihad Neibauer. And that came late on the play. But you're absolutely right. Kane, we probably didn't get to see as many personnel packages as Rocco expected going up against Delaware State. But getting into this game late where Delaware is up by 12 points at 10 minutes remaining.
And again, here's where we were talking about it on the last drive. They were unable to execute it. You want that 4 or 5 minute offense where you're taking your time, you're grinding clock, and you're moving the chain.
Walker stands as the quarterback. He's going to throw the football. Hit as he does so to Coleman, who holds it in DSU territory at the 35. Down he goes at the 34 in the first reception of the career of Gene Coleman.
Well, you knew one of those freshmen was going to get involved. It was a little bit of a mystery of which one would get on the board first. Well-run route that time, and a great job by Joe Walker off play action. Hang in there. He saw the pressure coming. He knew he was going to take a big hit from Christian Johnson. And there's that accuracy delivered. Great ball there.
Coleman joined Delaware in the spring after prepping at Milford Academy. So the freshman knew we were going to see him, and he gets his first catch on first down and 10 at the Delaware State territory. Hurtling a defender was Kane, but he only picked up a yard. Actually, that was Jefferson back in the ballgame.
Now these backs, they really do funnel in and out in a real quick period. That is something that, you know, Danny Rocco didn't think he would be worried about coming into this season, but there was a stage in camp where he wasn't quite so sure who he was going to have access to at the running back position. Hills had to leave the program. Jefferson was banged up with injuries. Kareem Williams had to sit for an extended stretch.
Kane is the back on second down and 9 after picking up a yard. It's
15-3. Delaware's lead 8:37 and ticking here in the fourth. Delaware keeping the ball on the ground with Kane to the outside, trying to cut it, but he's tackled by Jihad Neibauer as he gets to the 32-yard line, setting up third down and long for the Hens. See Cherry pop back in as Coleman will go to the bench. Hens will pitch the freshman.
And he has a very similar body type to Thomas Jefferson. And you can't tell the difference between the 9s and the 8s on these Delaware uniforms. I'm going to have to request a jersey change. I don't know about you.
They're not making it easy. I need either teams. They're making it easy for us up here. Third down and 8 minutes left in the fourth quarter as Delaware up 15-3. And Walker going to go play action. Has all day looking. Good coverage by DSU. Rolls out, throws it to Yoakum, who picks up first down yardage on the outside near the DSU sideline. Down he goes at the 21, just outside of the red zone. And how about Kyle Yoakum, the senior captain voted on in the second vote. They did one in the spring, one in the summer. And the senior from Exeter Township with his first catch.
I love it. You know, he's been so unselfish giving up his body tonight, and that fullback position at H-back slot where he comes in and has really moved some bodies up front, and that's good patience there from Joe Walker. Another accurate throw. He has really caught another hot streak here this last drive.
Walker 13 of 26 today. First and 10 just outside the red zone at the 21. It's Kane looking for some space, brought down inside the red zone at the 19, a pickup of 2 before Heslop brought him down with help from Harris.
You know, there are some concerns that they crop out of tonight's game that maybe weren't expecting the red zone offense, and here's an opportunity to maybe dispel them just a little bit. But there's also some encouragement that you were hoping for, but you weren't sure you were going to get. 192 passing yards for Delaware. We'll have to look it up. I don't remember the last time Delaware had 192 passing yards in a game. I think it's been a pretty long while.
It's been some time. This is never been 200 for Joe Walker. Second down and 8 in the red zone at the 19-yard line as Jefferson gives Kane a blow. On second and 8, they'll go the reverse to Cherry, who tucks it at the 20, to the 15, down the sideline, 10, diving from the 5. He touched the pylon, looking for a signal, and he's out of bounds right at the 1-yard line. A 5-yard dive by Deontay Terry, just shy of the 1-yard line, or of the end zone, an 18-yard run by Cherry.
Boy, he levitated through the air. You're not kidding. That's not hyperbole. He left his feet just outside the 5. I thought he was going to get knocked out around the 2, and he almost got that ball. You could argue he got that ball to the pylon. That thing hit the inside of the pylon in his possession. His feet were in the air, not out of bounds. That was a touchdown.
First and goal from the 1.
They're going to review it.
They are going to take a look.
I guess you don't.
Rocco wanted that call earlier, and now he finally gets it. As they showed that again on the big screen, you're absolutely right in your description. It looked like Deontay Cherry, who normal human beings wouldn't get close to the end zone on that dive. He took out off from the 5-yard line, which is like a basketball player jumping from the foul line and getting to the rim.
I think the frustration for Danny Rocco here especially is the fact that if the trail official does not have him stepping out of bounds before the jump, which is a lot of times what you see on that call, which he didn't, the ball hits the inside of the pylon. What made it not a touchdown? I think it was the back judge that said shy, so we're going to get another view of it here. They had Walker stay back for the flea flicker look. That's cut down some of the pursuit.
That's a touchdown. We're looking at it here at Delaware Stadium, and the ball touched the pylon before any knee was down.
The only thing you have to watch is that left foot. Did it touch down before that ball hit the pylon? But it sure looks from here like it did. Now the official's going to take a look. Now there's only so many angles, and it has to be absolutely definitive. So they have to see that foot airborne to overturn it. That looked definitive to me. But it's that left foot that's in question. That's the only thing that would have kept that from being 6.
Deontay Cherry, 4 catches, 83 yards, 1 touchdown. Will he have another? Still talking things over. They're looking at it up top. We're on the far side near the north end zone.
That's a good sign. He had the headset on. He took it back off. So maybe they're changing clock or something like that.
Let's listen.
After review, the ruling on the field has been changed. Touchdown!
The official gets the touchdown call. How about that? 21-3 as Cherry dove 5 yards
knock down the pylon. What a play it was. Two touchdown game for Deontay Cherry.
They might have to start a new moniker. He could look like Superman flying through the air there. That was very, very impressive. And you know, when the official has the headset on, takes it off, and then decides to put it back on, something's getting changed one way or the other. Because
to 6:22. 6:22 on the game clock.
Yeah, there is what it was, a little bit of extra time. But there you go. Delaware finally cashes into the red zone. You were looking for a positive vibe to kind of take away some of that storyline, and at least you were able to execute it here in the fourth quarter.
Rago on for the extra point. Sheets will snap it. Pritchard will hold. With 6:22 on the clock, Rago's PAT is up and through. 22-3, and now this game has been extended to where we thought the lead might be. It took a while to get there, but the Hens getting things going late, and maybe just tiring out Delaware State defensively. This is a DSU team that hasn't won a football game in a long time, only one in their last 22 coming in. Looking like they're going to be one in their last 23, and looks like Delaware's going to win today. And after Delaware wins this season, after every game broadcasted on WDSD, the Blue Hens radio team, that's us. We're going to celebrate by giving one lucky fan a $100 gift card from Acme. Sign up to win at WDSD.com starting tomorrow by going to the contest page at WDSD.com, and you can win just like the Hens. Still 6:22 left to go, but I think somebody might be getting an Acme gift card.
What's the fine print on that? Are we eligible?
I don't think so. I don't think so.
Well, I tell you, if you're Delaware and Danny Rocco, you're going to be chagrined by some execution issues that you had in the first 2.5 quarters, but you're going to like a lot of this result. There are a ton of positives that you can keep that vibe going with, but then there's a ton of teaching points that you're going to be able to go back and get a couple extra days of practice, a couple extra days of film work to correct that stuff before you start Virginia Tech Prep Week on Sunday. So those extra 2 days will probably be put to pretty good use.
9 plays, 86 yards, your Anchor Buick GMC drive summary. It ends with a touchdown by Deontay Cherry, and if that was a punt, it would have been perfect, but it goes out of bounds at the 1-yard line. And now some extracurricular, as it looks like Dallas Bryant and Armin Ware getting tangled, and Mike Diodati doing a great job at the dish, some jawing back and forth around the 20-yard line. Things getting heated as a flag is thrown, but that was for the illegal procedure on the kickoff by Jake Roth, who was a stellar performer as that place kicker. 22-3 is the count. Delaware going to improve, it looks like, with 6:22 left to 8-0 against Delaware State. But this was not last year's game where it was dominated from start to finish by Delaware over Delaware State. There's been some games in the past that have been close, and this will be one of the closer contests in recent history.
Really, I mean, the only game that comes anywhere close to this is that one. Remember, they got delayed and then eventually postponed to Saturday, or to Sunday, I should say. It was like we were playing the NFL game. But it was kind of a very similar game plan from Delaware State. They played more to stay close than they did to win the ball game. A lot of long drives, even though there weren't many plays, grind the play clock down. I give credit to the Delaware State coaching staff in that they were down by one score late in the third quarter, two scores early in the fourth quarter, midway through the fourth quarter, in a situation where they're overmatched talent-wise. Some of the calls I thought were a little perplexing, where they played directly into Delaware's strength, but they were able to come up with a game plan that maybe didn't put themselves in a prime position to win. But they're not really there with their program yet to beat a team from the CAA. But they put themselves in position to hang around. And I think if you're Delaware State, you probably can bring some positives out of this as well, particularly on the defensive side. We're a little confused what's going on at their quarterback position, though.
It was supposed to be Black. It was McDaniels. And now they're going to have Delaware re-kick this one. As Roth has it bounce at the 8-yard line, picked up by Elaine. Room to run at the 20 to the 30 with speed at the 35. He's tripped up and down he goes at the 38-yard line. That's where DSU will come out. Nasir Adderley with the tackle. DSU, a game against Delaware, and then an early, not a conference game, against Hampton next week. They've got West Virginia after that, and then later in the season, they end their year against Florida State. Wow. How about that for a non-conference schedule?
Yeah, I know it's going to
pay the bills.
Yeah, it's going to pay for their athletics for the next year, but that's a brutal way to wrap it up in the heat of the Florida sun as well. But I will say, they've got to find a way to win an FCS game in non-conference play. It's been 5 years since they have won a non-conference game at their level.
McDaniels back in as the quarterback. He'll drop back, looking left, surveying the field and throwing. He has a man, and it's broken up at the 35-yard line by Ray Jones. He has been everywhere. A pop that time on Jordan Hanna, jarred it loose.
And one of the things you have to love most about that, Scott, is, you know, 10 years ago when this sport was different, that to kill shot from Jones. But now, especially after you see Colby Reader get called for targeting, you can't afford to lose Jones either. Shoulder right into the chest. Doesn't go high, doesn't lower the head. That is textbook stuff from Jones.
Jones now the junior from Hodgson Votech. On second and 10, McDaniels drops it off to West, the running back, catches it at the 40, advances to the 41-yard line, wrapped up there. Armin Ware was there. Tommy Wilmot, a Delaware native, in on the tackle as well.
It's pop quiz time. They go a little bit deeper into the depth chart. We'll see how much time our play-by-play announcer had a chance to memorize the roster, although some familiar names there.
5:42 and ticking. Delaware 22-3. Third down and 6 as McDaniels stands in shotgun. West to his right. Low snap. He dropped it. Picked it up. Hit as he throws, and it's caught. Nice toss by the freshman in Delaware territory at the 38. Sua got an net from Honolulu, having a great contest. That's the fourth catch for almost 100 yards by Gattinette. 20 right there. He's at 93 for the game.
That's an incredible play by the quarterback, McDaniels. That ball was at his feet, bent down, picked it up, had Nichols in his grill, and just swung it out there. Knew where his receiver would be without having much time to look.
I think McDaniels earned that starting role as a freshman. Rolling out of the pocket now on first down and 10 in Delaware territory. Tosses it, and it's dropped behind the intended target, Jordan Hanna, on the far side of the field.
You know, the one thing that's kind of odd about him, I mean, he has plenty of arm strength. You can't make that throw he did on the previous play without arm strength, but sometimes he kind of guides the ball instead of throwing through it, and it makes him look like he doesn't quite have enough behind the arm to get it out there to the far sideline. So I think that's something that will be a teaching point, that, you know, he's got a lot of room for growth to get better. And obviously a lot of football left in front of him. You'd think Del State's got a pretty good chance to actually have a quarterback start two straight years for the first time since Nick Elko.
It would be something. Second down and 10 from the 38. Passes deflected by big Bilal Nichols, who got his hand on it at the 40-yard line. Interesting enough, we talk about Sua Gattinette, his leading receiver. Jack McDaniels, the quarterback, he went to high school 5 miles away from Sua Gattinette's high school. That in itself not very odd, but when you think about it, it was in Hawaii. They both went to high school in Hawaii and traveled quite some distance, over almost 5,000 miles away, to become Hornets.
Completed 68% of his passes his final year. I know the weather in Hawaii is passer friendly, but it's an impressive percentage of a high school quarterback.
Ends up 22-3 here. McDaniels throwing the football low for a diving target at the 25, incomplete. Looking for wide receiver Kwani Kali, and it falls incomplete. Fourth down and 10 with 5:02 remaining in Delaware, up 22-3.
Pretty good closing speed from Malcolm Brown and Troy Reader, though, huh? I mean, that looked like it was an open throw when he stepped into it. And by the time that ball arrived, he had about a 6-inch window to fit it through.
There to go for it on fourth down and 10 in Delaware territory at the 38, approaching the 5-minute mark in the fourth quarter. McDaniels dropping back, pressure coming from Woodson, flushed out of the pocket, throwing on the run towards the sideline. It's incomplete, and a turnover on downs. Looking for Sua Gattinette, but he had to come back and dive for it. It didn't reach him.
That might be the punctuation mark on what was a fantastic day for the Delaware defense. I mean, the stats got a little less ugly for Delaware State in the second half. They had an okay third quarter, early portion of the fourth, but you see, you hold a team to 203 yards, 58 yards rushing. You're going to take that if you're Danny Rocco and company.
We're going to see J.P. Caruso, the transfer from Appalachian State, come in. Really put the pressure on Joe to step up this summer. Joe responding and ended up being a captain, but we see J.P. Caruso, who was a top 40 passer, dual threat QB coming out of high school. give us to Spruill. We see him for the first time. A freshman that we talked about in the pregame show gets past the 40 to the 43-yard line. So these are names that you're going to hear for years if everything works out for Delaware. Corey Spruill, Connie Kane, last possession. And we're going to see some other guys get in the mix. Ty McElhaney, the freshman wide receiver, will be in for the first time. We saw Chichi Amachi out there. A lot of guys getting in the mix. Joey Carter in for the first time as well.
Yeah, two freshmen go in, two freshmen go out. That's a good sign.
4:22 and ticking, fourth quarter, Delaware in control. 22-3, Spruill again, stiff arm, looking for some space, has none, and might have lost a yard on second and five.
Yeah, if you're Spruill, you're kind of thinking, boy, this is tough. I'm running with twos in front of me against the ones on defense. There was not much room for him there, but I like the motor. The spin, broke a tackle, awful lot of fight to get his way back to the line of scrimmage.
Cavacanti in on the tackle. He's had a good day defensively, leading this Delaware State charge. 3:51 and ticking. Fourth quarter, 22-3, third down and five for DSU, or for Delaware, excuse me. We've got Alex Sheets in as the H-back. Caruso going to throw for the first time as a blue hen. It's complete. Caught by MJ Kehoe, the tight end, right at the 48-yard line, which I believe is the spot he needed to get to advance the stick. So nice job by Kehoe, knowing where he needed to go. And picking up the first down, Devin Smith with a good pop on the tight end.
So his brother's a quarterback, and he's got a lot of upside at that tight end position. He can block. He's got good hands, pretty athletic kid, and they really like his future.
Running back is Spruill behind Caruso as we're approaching the three-minute mark. First and 10 from the 49 of Del State. Caruso going to throw again. This one caught. Good hands by McElhaney. His first catch. He tripped himself up just shy of the first down marker, but Caruso starts 2 of 2, finding two players that each will get their first career reception.
Spread the wealth.
Absolutely.
Good hands catch too. That ball was a little out in front. He was trying to turn it up. He ran through the catch and the guy himself going a little too fast for his own good, and that's why he slipped down. But over 200 yards passing just about tonight for Delaware.
And the offense up over 400 yards total in this game. Second down and two from the Hornets' 43-yard line. We'll see Spruill, the freshman from DeMatha, busting through and staying on his feet all the way to the 34-yard line. Another first down pickup by the Hens.
You know, DeMatha has had some really incredible players over the years. Probably the best recently, Brian Westbrook was a DeMatha graduate. But that's a football factory. And Spruill, he said, the competition that he had to deal with for playing time in high school has put him in a good position to come here to Delaware and compete for playing time.
And how about our man Connor Bozick getting some looks in the NFL over the summer? We wish him the best of luck. First and 10, the carry again to Spruill. He'll lose a couple back to the 35. Some extracurricular activity as it looked like some pushing and shoving going on. Still some jawing.
A great job by the coaching staff to back that away immediately. Three coaches almost out near the numbers pulling their guys back. Is Dylan Zimmerman a little over-anxious to just be out there and be in the mix? Gene Coleman the second. A couple of freshmen, they'll learn.
You have an impressive depth chart. Dylan Zimmerman not even listed on the Delaware roster that we were given. You've got it, though. Second down and 12, Caruso dropping back, has some time, shuffling his feet, throws it high for boys, and out of bounds. Boy, 22-3 is the count, 1:14 remaining. Delaware going to start off the year 1-0.
Giving Caruso some reps here. Yeah. You know, you bring him in from Appalachian State. He competed, came up just a little bit short for the starting job, but you always like to have a guy ready to go in the wings. Football, we've seen the violent nature of the game, and you've got to have depth at every position. That includes quarterback, where you get the least number of reps during the week in practice and obviously in the games. You don't get many opportunities in live action.
Kane is the running back, and he'll get another touch, some room to the left side, an opening at the 30-yard line, and he ducks ahead, still on his feet as they were late to blow that whistle up at around the 28-yard line. And they should have blown that much earlier because now Malik Harris is getting in the mix. Flags are flying. And they kind of let that play, I think, go a little long and could have avoided the penalty.
You're so right. And Kane's going to get the penalty. And hopefully he had his hand open because he took a swing at one of the Del State players. If the hand's open, it's not a punch. And he's not ejected. If it's a punch, he's gone. and Danny Rocco went out and took Kane off the sideline. But that's when we're trying to make the game safer. Blow the whistle,
right,
especially at this stage of the game, and protect the players. It happens all the time. It's not that hard to blow a whistle, and you get guys taking two or three extra shots as a result.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, offense number 29, 15-yard penalty, fourth down. That is number 29's first unsportsmanlike of the game.
It's nice. That's a learning experience for the new guy here in Newark. I understand why he's frustrated. He thinks the play is over. He had given up on the play. But Adel State's defense are playing until the whistle. And it's been getting chippy. That's the thing that makes even less sense that they didn't blow the whistle. It's been chippy for 5-6 snaps. Stay on top of it. I think that's what Danny Rocco is telling the officials right now. What are you guys doing? Pay attention. We got college kids down here that are able to focus for the full 60 minutes. Where are you guys here down the stretch?
59 seconds left. And Ann's going to come away with the victory. They will punt, though, as it's fourth down and very long. Sua got it. It was a great start to his sophomore campaign. We'll be back to return. Let's see if Pritchard can place this one inside the 10-yard line. It'll bounce. Take a DSU hop from the 11 back to the 19-yard line, and that's 25 yards. Won't help the average for Nick Pritchard, but
what my sandwich to do that, though. That had a pretty backspin on it.
So 51 seconds remaining. Delaware going to win this one. Start their season off 1-0 against Del State. 8-0 all time against the Hornets. And Delaware got some reps by some new guys as well. Don't go anywhere as we end this bowl game. We'll have the American Spirit Federal Credit Union coming up. We'll talk with head coach Danny Rocco. We'll get you a player as well. Corey Nido will be doing that in the Delaware locker room. We'll also have final stats. Benny Pinella will have the game recap as well. It's all coming up after 51 seconds tick off the clock. Still starting quarterback in. Jack McDaniel is going to play this one start to finish as he goes in shotgun form from his own 19-yard line. Didn't see Keenan Black, a couple other options available for DSU at quarterback. McDaniel is going to throw up the field, and it's caught around the 40-yard line, down at the 40-yard line. Teniana Woosie with the tackle, and the catch was made by Quani Cali.
Well, I don't know if it was gamesmanship or some sort of a late suspension or injury that forced the change, but if it was gamesmanship and this is your starter moving forward, you might as well get the freshman your reps.
165 yards through the air for McDaniels, and he'll throw, dumping it off high for Waters. And falls incomplete, stopping the clock at 29 seconds. So DSU trying to get the most out of whatever seconds are left in their opener. Kenny Carter is going to fall to 1-22 all-time as a head coach. He is the one of only three coaches in FCS history to coach more than 20 games and have only one win.
Poor guy, too, because I mean, it's not like he's experienced much of this in his career. Before that, he was on Charlie Strong's staff at Louisville. All they did was win. Before that, Urban Meyer's staff in Florida, where he won a national title as an assistant.
And it's McDaniels with some trouble as he snaps that one. Tackle made by Grant Roberts, a Delaware native from Concord.
McKenna Carter really wants some reps for his offense. He's taking a time out here.
So Kenny Carter going to take a timeout with 21 seconds left. Always coaching, I guess, right?
Yeah, you know, we were talking about, you know, getting J.P. Caruso reps, and it's not running up the clock because you're trying to get guys experience. There's no preseason in college football. You don't get those dress rehearsals. You scrimmage against your own guys. This is your first actual game action. Maybe trying to see if they can run a little two-minute drill, work their way into field goal range, and bring something positive offensively out of it.
We'll have the presentation of the first state cup after this ball game. We'll also announce the Nate Beasley MVP award. Some great candidates, Cherry, with the two touchdowns. 83 yards receiving. Jefferson up over 100 yards. And Cam Kitchen with a safety and a fumble recovery. So a lot of candidates for that MVP trophy.
I've kind of lost track. Is this still officially deemed the Route 1 rivalry, or is that going by the wayside?
I have deemed it an in-state matchup. That's it's got downgraded, I believe. I think they tried to take the rivalry portion of it out a few years ago. McDaniels will throw it long up for grabs and intercepted by Delaware. On the far side of the field, it's 16, Nigel Hill. We couldn't see the numbers on the far side of the field. And Nigel Hill, the redshirt freshman, gets the interception. Nigel Hill is going to be a good one. A redshirt freshman offers from FBS schools like Old Dominion and Toledo and gets an interception there on what will probably be the final offensive play of the game.
I think Nigel Hill is very pleased with Kenny Carter right now for that last timeout with 22 seconds to go. He'll take that in the stat sheet.
So Delaware's offense will come back out. We expect an E from J.P. Caruso.
Best formation in football.
The winning formation for Delaware. And Danny Rocco has been a winner his whole career. He'll start off a winner at Delaware. Caruso will take the knee, and it becomes official. Delaware starts off the season 22-3, the victory over Delaware State. And the Danny Rocco era begins with a W. We'll stay right here as we got plenty going on post-game, but it'll start with the first State Cup presentation, also the Nate Beasley MVP Award. You'll hear from head coach Danny Rocco and a player as well. We'll have final stats for you. We'll have a recap back in the studio with Benny Pinella. But we got plenty of time to look over numbers. Your initial thoughts on this one, man?
Positives and negatives, but I think the positives outweigh the negatives if you're looking big picture. A lot of things to clean up. I think Danny Rocco will be the first person to say that and admit that. But his defense played through a lot of adversity, never let it affect him. When they finally bent a little, they were able to hold a team out from the one-yard line and get them to three at the end of the first half. And just a dominant performance across the board on that side of the ball. Offensively, the most balance we've seen from a Delaware offense in a game where it didn't really get away from them late and they were forced to throw on every single play. This was true balance. Now, can they do it long term against better opponents? That remains to be seen, but a real step forward for the passing attack. Real stretches of very good play from Joe Walker. Needs to be a bit more consistent still with the accuracy, but boy, he had some stretches where the ball was absolutely on the money, so stuff to build on. I thought Jamie Jarman was fantastic, even though the stat sheet doesn't necessarily play it out, but I thought he ran some great routes. They missed him a couple of times, and I thought that he threw a couple of big blocks on the edge and ran some routes that got his teammates open, and then Deontay Cherry bouncing back from that first drop. That could have killed you. To start your senior season, it really hurt you emotionally. And Cherry didn't let his head slip. He came back and he ended up putting together a fantastic game. He's probably going to be the MVP. I mean, four catches, 83 yards, a touchdown run. I don't see many other candidates that are going to surpass those numbers.
And he flew through the air to get that second touchdown. Very impressive day for Deontay Cherry, who opened up the game with that drop on what would have been a touchdown. More than made up for that as the game went on. Deontay Cherry with 83 yards through the air receiving, and he's going to come very close to 1,000 yards. He'll get that over his career. He's been good from the start. Cherry was a guy that came in and had 35 catches as a freshman, 27 a year ago, and he's been a part of, he's been at times a bright note in a passing game that hasn't gone very well, and we hope that this is just a start to what is a great redshirt senior year for Deontay Cherry. The team, we always like to see that, the celebration after a win with the fight song. So the Hens cheering in front of the pep band. How about that student section turnout? We always love the first game of the year, the energy, the excitement. The student section was packed today, and I thought that was great to see.
A lot of carryover onto the far side. You know, we see that during the opener every year. How long do they stay? Well, tonight the game was relatively competitive. They stayed deep into the third quarter despite even a couple of spurts of rain. So that's a great sign. Hopefully they enjoyed what they saw. We'll see them back in two more weeks. That's the nice part. Remember last year, it was hard to build momentum because there weren't a lot of wins. But it was also hard to build momentum because you had a home game and then you had three road games and a bye week. You went more than a month without another home game. And I think half the students forgot we had a football program by the time the team came back, unfortunately. So hopefully we'll see it again in a couple of weeks.
And it looks like Deontay Cherry is out there as they're going to present the award. And he is going to win the Nate Beasley MVP Award. Well-deserved. Deontay Cherry, four catches, 83 yards, and a touchdown. His touchdown was the first score of the season. Came back to get a 31-yard pass from Joe Walker. Excellent job by Deontay Cherry there. And then on the reverse, he got the run, scoring from 5 yards out. He dove. They reviewed it. The pylon fell, and they eventually called it a score on the reversal of the call. So one carry, 19 yards for Deontay Cherry to go along with those four catches. He'll be the Nate Beasley MVP award, and they had to go grab the first state cup out of the Delaware football offices to bring it back out and present the trophy again to the team. But great to see the team all lined up behind Deontay Cherry right now and the trophy at the 45-yard line. A great way to start off the season with a win.
You know, the nice part is I know it's a state of two very different programs, especially two very different times, but anytime you have a trophy game and it has never left your home since the time it left the trophy maker's store, you're going to live with that if you're Delaware. It's nice to always have a piece of hardware that you can count on. And Deontay Cherry, you got to be proud of the guy for bounce back. That was a crusher when he dropped the football, the deflation on the Delaware sideline because it was a third down play, and also in the stands. And he just went right back to work, and that's a good sign from a guy that's really grown up over the course of his Delaware career, mentally and physically. Big kid now, strong kid. He's always been athletic. I think that strength will help him, but the mental strength on full display tonight.
He had the suspension last year for a game, so again, mentally tough, and a guy that's not mentally tough doesn't bounce back, as you mentioned, after that drop pass. 96 catches now on his career after getting four today. And Cherry, the redshirt senior from Lancaster, Pennsylvania. I know who else is excited about Deontay Cherry taking home that MVP award. How about his over 6,000 Twitter followers? He's certified on Twitter. He's got the check next to his name.
Hey,
he's famous.
Deservedly so. He's got some entertaining tweets.
Absolutely. We're big fans of Deontay Cherry, a social media star, that's for sure, and only shining brighter after tonight.
Corey Nido's pretty happy as well. Not a bad debut in our UD pregame fantasy game.
That's right. He chose Cherry. I actually talked him out of, I believe, one of another pick. So nice job by Corey Nido, who's going to talk with head coach Danny Rocco in a little bit. The captains out there on the field to get the trophy presentation: Brody Kern, Troy Reeder, Kyle Yoakum, Joe Walker, Bilal Nichols, Charles Bell, all out there with Dr. Asanis holding up that trophy and getting some photos taken. Always a pleasant point in the evening when Delaware can not only get the win, but also have some pomp and circumstance in this first game. We got a trophy game to start the year. It would be great if we won that trophy game to end the year as well. But a lot that will occur in between Del State and Villanova to end the year. But a promising start for a team that went 4-7 a season ago, 2-6 in conference play. They got the victory 22-3. So with that, we're going to take our first time out on the American Spirit Federal Credit Union post-game.